Good evening. I'm Richard Gilman, president of Pan American Center. On behalf of Penn, I welcome you to this important occasion. Before I actually introduce the program, I want to offer my thanks and those of Penn to some people who've made the evening possible. First to Joe Papp for so generously giving us space here, and then to Tom Wallace and Gay Talese, to Jeff Ripps, Ellen Binder, and Karen Kennelly of the Penn staff. Finally, not least, to the distinguished writers and actors who've come here to read. I should also tell you that there'll be a reception afterwards where you may buy the poster many of you have seen and make donations, if you wish, for the work of Penn in the area of freedom of expression. I have also some last-minute information that I've been charged to give you. There's a sentence on this paper which reads, "You are advised that your attendance here may be recorded and televised and distributed in any media." Sounds a bit sinister. There are some last-minute changes. I'm sorry to say that Edward Albee will not be able to participate due to illness. There is a certain irony in the fact that the book from which he was going to read, One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich, has been banned in both the USSR and the United States. Arthur Miller and Lee Grant also will not be able to participate for various reasons, so that the section from The Death of a Salesman will not be read. The work of Penn in the area of freedom of expression is mainly carried on by our Freedom to Write Committee, which has done a great deal on behalf of imprisoned or persecuted writers, imprisoned or harassed because of their writing, throughout the world. Tonight, we launch a new project of Penn, the American Right to Read, the initial funding for which has been provided by the Educational Foundation of America, to whose board I want to express my gratitude, with special thanks to Rocco Landisman. This project had its inception in a realization on the part of many Penn members that while blows against freedom of expression may be more severe in other countries than they have been here, we have been receiving them too. To be complacent about our relative liberty is to risk deepening the loss of it. And as you almost know, there's been an increase, a rather startling one in fact, in the number of books banned or against which attempts at censorship have been made in various American communities. The American Right to Read Project will send writers around the country to talk to student groups and parent-teacher associations about the values of writing and the value of free and unhindered reading, as well as the crucial importance of the maintenance of cultural pluralism. Where book banning is an actual, immediate issue, our writers will work with civil liberty groups on censorship cases that are being litigated and will speak out in defense of the right of free access to books. Apropos of the books from which excerpts will be read tonight, these books have been pulled from library shelves or out of classrooms mostly during the last 5 or 6 years. Most of them are what we call classics. All of them are well known, and some of them are greatly surprising. My own young daughters, voracious readers both, were astonished to learn that The Wizard of Oz and Mary Poppins were on the list. What could possibly be wrong with those books? One of them asked me. I started to explain in political and cultural terms, then simply said, well, there are some strange people in the world, something they'd already begun to suspect. We'll find out tonight what's wrong with all these books, or rather, of course, what those strange people have considered wrong. The specific information about the banning or censorship of the particular books will be found on the back of your program. There's one correction to that list on the back of the program. Removed from its classes and libraries, such books as Malamud's The Fixer, Vonnegut's Slaughterhouse-Five, Cleaver's Soul on Ice, and Morris's The Naked Ape. The grounds were that the books were anti-American, anti-Christian, anti-Semitic, and just plain filthy. I'm bemused by the word filthy in this context, but I even more by the word plain. To the mind of the censor, professional or amateur, all filth, all immorality, or all heresy for that matter, is, linguistically, plain, self-evident, unmistakable. The psychic and philosophical origins of such a conviction lie in a desperate kind of nominalism, a besieged process of reification by which words are mistaken for things or are made into them. This malady is at the heart of book burning and is what we have to fight. Bernard Shaw once pointed out that when the British theater was under the censorship powers of the Lord Chamberlain, you could have a character on stage who was clearly a prostitute, but you couldn't use the word prostitute. To such mind, the letter kills. Naturally, we believe it gives life. Thank you.
Good evening. I want to apologize. I'm up here first because I have to run away. There's another meeting tonight of the an anti-nuclear group, and I'm going to read a selection up there from a book that, unless this goes really well, will definitely be on the hit list next year. It's Jonathan Schell's book, The Future of the World. I chose Ray Bradbury because I'd never read a work of science fiction. After I finished reading the book, I had a very short and a wonderful dream. I was passing a beautiful old bookshop and an antique shop, and I said out to a lot of people, consider the wonder and the joy of reading books. And then I looked at an old chest and I said, consider the wonders of that beautiful chest and all the books inside. And then I looked at an old table and I said, consider the joy of eating and food for thought. And a voice shouted at me, yes, yes, but consider the cost. And rollicking with laughter, I shouted back and said, yes, yes, but just consider, you only have one life to live. This is from Ray Bradbury. About 2 years ago, a letter arrived from a solemn young Vassar lady telling me how much she enjoyed reading my experiment in space mythology, The Martian Chronicles. But she added, wouldn't it be a good idea this late in time to rewrite the book, inserting more women's characters and roles? A few years before that, I got a certain amount of mail concerning the same Martian book, complaining that the blacks in the book were Uncle Toms, and why didn't I do them over? Along about then came a note from a Southern white suggesting that I was prejudiced in favor of the blacks and the entire story should be dropped. 2 weeks ago, my mountain of mail delivered forth a pipsqueak mouse of a letter from a well-known publishing house that wanted to reprint my story, The Foghorn, in a high school reader. In my story, I had described a lighthouse as having late at night an illumination coming from it that was a god light. Looking up at it from the viewpoint of any sea creature, one would have felt that one was in the presence. The editors had deleted Godlight and In the Presence. Some 5 years back, the editors of yet another anthology for school readers put together a volume with some 400, count them, short stories in it. How do you cram 400 short stories by Twain, Irving, Poe, Maupassant, and Bierce into one book? Simplicity itself. Skin, debone, demarrow, scarify, melt, render down, and destroy. Every adjective that counted, every verb that moved, every metaphor that weighed more than a mosquito, out. Every simile that would have made a submoron's mouth twitch, gone. Any aside that explained the two-bit philosophy of a first-rate writer, lost. Every story, slenderized, starved, blue-penciled, leached, and bled white, resembled every other story. Twain read like Poe, read like Shakespeare, read like Dostoevsky, read like, in the finale, Edgar Guest. Every word of more than three syllables had been razored, every image that demanded so much as one instant's attention, shot dead. Do you begin to get the damned and incredible picture? How did I react? To all of the above, by firing the whole lot, by sending rejection slips to each and every one, by ticketing the assembly of idiots to the far reaches of hell. The point is obvious. There is more than one way to burn a book, and the world is full of people running about with lit matches. Every minority, be it Baptist, Unitarian, Irish, Italian, octogenarian, Zen, Buddhist, Zionist, Seventh-day Adventist, Women's Lib, Republican, Mattachine, Four Square Gospel, feels it has the will, the right, the duty to douse the kerosene, light the fuse. Every dimwit editor who sees himself as the source of all dreary, blank, mange, plain porridge, unleavened literature, licks his guillotine and eyes the neck of any author who dares to speak above a whisper or write above a nursery rhyme. Fire Captain Beatty, in my novel, Fahrenheit 451, described how the book... Fire! That's a sign from God. Fire Captain Beatty. Fire Captain Beatty. Fire Captain Beatty. Fire Captain Beatty, in my novel, Fahrenheit 451, described how the books were burned, first by minorities, until each ripping a page or a paragraph from this book, then that, until the day came when the books were empty and the mines shut and the libraries closed forever. Shut the door, they're coming through the window. Shut the window, they're coming through the door, are the words to an old song. They fit my lifestyle with newly arriving butcher censors every month. Only 6 weeks ago, I discovered that over the years, some cubbyhole editors at Ballantine Books, fearful of contaminating the young, had bit by bit censored some 75 separate sections from the novel. Students reading the novel, which after all deals for it is a mad world and it will get madder if we allow the minorities, be they dwarf or giant, orangutan or dolphin, nuclear head or water conservationist, pro-computerologist or neo-Luddite, simpleton or sage, to interfere with aesthetics. The real world is the playing ground for each and every group to make or unmake laws. But the tip of the nose of my book or stories or poems is where the rights end and my territorial imperatives begin, run, and rule. If Mormons do not like my plays, let them write their own. If the Irish hate my Dublin stories, let them rent typewriters. If teachers and grammar school editors find my jawbreaker sentences shatter their mushmilk teeth, let them eat stale cake dunked in weak tea of their own ungodly manufacture. For let's face it, digression is the soul of wit. Take philosophic asides away from Dante, Milton, or Hamlet's father's ghost, and what stays is dry bones. Lawrence Stern said it once, digressions incontestably are the sunshine, the life, the soul of reading. Take them out, and one cold eternal winter would reign in every page. Restore them to the writer. He steps forth like a bridegroom, bids all hail, brings in variety, and forbids the appetite to fail. In sum, do not insult me with the beheadings, finger choppings, or the lung deflations you planned for my works. I need my head to shake or nod, my hand to wave or make into a fist, my lungs to shout or whisper with. I will not go gently unto a shelf, degutted to become a non-book. All you umpires, back to the bleachers. Referees, hit the shower. It's my game. I pitch, I hit, I catch, I run the bases. At sunset, I've won or lost. At sunrise, I'm out again, giving it the old try. And no one can help me, not even you. Thank you.
I'm proud to represent tonight the Treasury of American Poetry, which had the misfortune to carry a poem of mine, Getting Down to Get Over, in a poem by Allen Ginsberg, Howl, on the basis of which the good people in Gretna, Virginia, saw fit to remove the Treasury of American Poetry. So I'd like to read tonight this poem, Getting Down to Get Over, which is dedicated to my mother and which I wrote 10 years ago, and which is tonight dedicated to the people in Gretna, Virginia. The poem goes like this. Mama, 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 mammy, nanny, granny, woman, sister, love, black girl, slave girl, gal, honey child, sweet stuff, sugar, sweetheart, baby, 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 Mama, mama, black mama, black bitch, black pussy, piece of tail, nice piece of ass. Hey, daddy. Hey, bro. We walk together and talk together and dance and do together, dance and do. Hey, daddy. Hey, bro. Hey, Nina, Nikki, Noni, Nomo, Nomo, mama, black woman, black female head of household, black matriarchal, matriarchy, black statistical, low life, low level, low down, and up to be black statistical, low factor, factotum, factitious, fictitious, figment, figuring in low down, lying, annual reports. Black woman, black, hallelujah, saintly, patient, smiling, humble, giving thanks for annual reports and monthly dole and Friday night and good God, Monday morning, black and female, martyr masochist, a big white lie, mama, mama. What does motherfucking mean? Who's the motherfucker? Fuck my mama, messed yours over and right now be tripping on my starved black female soul, a Mack truck motherfucker. The first primordial, the paradigmatic, dogmatistic motherfucker. Who is he? Hey, mama, 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 mama. Dry eyes on the shy, dark, hidden, crying black face of the loneliness, the rape, the broke up mailbox, and no Western Union roses come inside the kitchen, and no poem take you through the whole night, and no big black burly hand be holding yours to have to hold on to. No big black burly hand, no Nomo, no black prince come riding from the darkness on a beautiful black horse. No bro, no daddy. I was 16 when I met my father in a bar in Baltimore. He told me who he was and what he does, paid for the drinks. I looked, I listened, and I left him. It was civil perfectly and absolute bullshit. The drinks was leaking water weak and never got down to my knees. Hey, daddy, what they been and done to you and what you been and done to me too? Mama, 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 hey, sugar daddy, big daddy, sweet daddy, black daddy, the original father divine, the ever-loving deep. Tall, bad, buck, jive, cold, strut, bop, split, tight, loose, close, hot, 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 sweet, sweet daddy, where you been and when you coming back to me? Hey, when you coming back to mama, 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 mama? And suppose he finally say, look, baby, I loves me some everything about you. Let me be your man. That reach around the hurting like a dream, and I ain't never waking up from that one. Mama, 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 mama. Consider the queen, hand on her hip, sweat resting from the corn bean greensfield, steamy under the pale, sly, suffocating sun. Consider the queen, she fixed the cufflinks on his Sunday shirt and fry some chicken, bake some cake, and tell the family, never mind about the boss man, don't know how a human being's supposed to act, just never mind about him, wash your face, sit down, and let the good Lord bless this table. Consider the queen, her baby's pulling at the nipples, pulling at the mama milk. The infant fingers gingerly approach, caress the soft black swollen mama breast. And there, inside the mama soft life spilling treasure chest, the heart breaks, rage by grief, by sorrow, weary, weary, breaks, breaks, quiet, silently, the weary sorrow, quiet now, the furious, the adamant, the broken, busted, beaten down and beaten up, the beaten, 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 weary heart beats tender, steady, and the babies suck. The seed of blood and love glows at the soft black swollen mama breast. Consider the queen. She works when she works in the laundry, in jail, in the schoolhouse, in jail, in the office, in jail, on the soapbox, in jail, on the desk, on the floor, on the street, on the line, at the door, looking fine at the head of the line, stepping sharp from behind in the light with a song, wearing boots or a belt and a gun, drinking wine when it's time, when the long week is done. But she works when she works in the laundry, in jail. She works when she works. Consider the queen. She sleeps when she sleeps with the king in the kingdom. She sleeps when she sleeps with the wall, with whatever it is who happens to call, with me and with you, To survive, you make do, you explore more and more. So she sleeps when she sleeps, a really deep sleep. Consider the queen, a full black glorious, a purple rose aroused by the tiger breathing beside her, a shell with the moaning of ages inside her, a hungry one feeding the folk what they need. Consider the queen. Mama, 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 family face, face of the family alive. Mama, mammy, mama, woman, sister, baby, love. The house on fire, poison waters, earthquake, and the air, a nightmare. Turn, turn, turn around the national gross product growing really gross. Turn, turn, turn the pestilence away, the miserable killers in Canarsie, Alabama. People begging to be people, warfare on the welfare of the folk. Hey, turn, turn away the trick bag university, the trick bag propaganda, trick bag tricklings. Forecast be the last one we will ever want to listen to. And daddy see the stars fall down and burn a light into the singing darkness of your eyes. My daddy, my black man, you take my body in your arms. You use the oil of coconuts, of trees and flowers, fish and new fruits from the new world to inflame me in this otherwise cold place. Please. Meanwhile, mama, 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 teach me how to kiss the king within the kingdom. Teach me how to TCB, to make do and be like you. Teach me to survive, my mama. Teach me how to hold a new life. Mama, help me turn the face of history to your face.
The first book to be not only banned but burned in this new land was called The Meritorious Price of Our Redemption, a treatise that vigorously disagreed with certain tenets of Puritan theology. In the marketplace of Boston in 1650, the public executioner set fire to the offending book. The offending author, William Pynchon, was more fortunate. He was allowed to leave for England, which he speedily did. I begin with a burning, in part because I shall end with one, a contemporary burning of heresy. With just a few minutes, I shan't try to provide a comprehensive chronological history of censorship and attempts thereat in America. Instead, some indication of the diversity of our lust to do away with, or at least quarantine, dangerous ideas, dangerous language, dangerous, wretched writers. I shall leave all talk of the First Amendment, the First Amendment law, to Charles Rembar, except to note that only 7 years after the First Amendment had been adopted, Congress passed the Alien and Sedition Acts, under which a number of writers and editors soon went to jail, not for anything they did, that is, not for any actions, but for what they thought and wrote. In the 19th century, I suppose the one figure whose memory reverberates most significantly and chillingly here tonight, particularly in view of what this recalls of that period, is the man who said, "I unhesitatingly declare there is at present no more active agent employed by Satan in civilized communities to ruin the human family and subject the nations to himself than evil reading." That man was Anthony Comstock, who was responsible in 1873 for the passage of the Comstock Act, which, as Mr. Rembar has written, provided the model for most American obscenity statutes for many strenuously imaginative years to come. Obscenity, of course, was only one of Satan's stratagems that had to be smashed. Before the Civil War, For instance, every southern state except Kentucky passed laws controlling and could not bring itself to go quite that far. Into the present, two undeniable, I think, points. One, there are more attempts at censorship, particularly in school libraries, than at any time since the Joe McCarthy, Roy Cohn years. Why not give the living his due? These attacks on books are taking place in 1/5 of the schools of this country. Half of the attempts to expel a book entirely or remove it from required reading lists, or get it put on a restricted shelf, a new use for the term restrictive covenant, half of these attempts succeed. And the most alarming statistic of all, in nearly 85% of these challenges to books, there is no local newspaper or broadcast coverage. Parents don't know about it. Other members of the community don't know about it. The principal strikes a deal. In the literature of library science, it's called a Zug-Gornish deal. Don't say anything, it never happened. From that keen desire to avoid trouble comes a growing phenomenon. There are reports of it, of its advent from Minnesota, certain parts of New York State, and in the South. Certain authors' new books are no longer ordered by school libraries, no matter what the reviews say, no matter how much interest the kids in the school have shown in that author's work. And one such author is Judy Blume. The second undeniable fact of the current war against books is that much of it is being conducted
your eyes, my daddy, my black man, you take my body in your arms. You use the oil of coconuts, of trees and flowers, fish and new fruits from the new world to inflame me in this otherwise cold place, please. Meanwhile, mama, 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 teach me how to kiss the king within the kingdom. Teach me how to TCB, to make do and be like you. Teach me to survive, my mama. Teach me how to hold a new life. Mama, help me turn the face of history to your face.
The first book to be not only banned but burned in this new land was called The Meritorious Price of Our Redemption, a treatise that vigorously disagreed with certain tenets of Puritan theology. In the marketplace of Boston in 1650, the public executioner set fire to the offending book. The offending author, William Pynchon, was more fortunate. He was allowed to leave for England, which he speedily did. I begin with a burning, in part because I shall end with one, a contemporary burning of heresy. With just a few minutes, I shan't try to provide a comprehensive chronological history of censorship and attempts thereat in America. Instead, some indication of the diversity of our lust to do away with, or at least quarantine, dangerous ideas, dangerous language, dangerous, wretched writers. I shall leave all talk of the First Amendment law to Charles Rembar, except to note that only 7 years after the First Amendment had been adopted, Congress passed the Alien and Sedition Acts, under which a number of writers and editors soon went to jail. Not for anything they did, that is, not for any actions, but for what they thought and wrote. In the 19th century, I suppose the one figure whose memory reverberates most significantly and chillingly here tonight, particularly in view of what this recalls of that period, is the man who said, "I unhesitatingly declare there is at present no more active agent employed by Satan in civilized communities to ruin the human family and subject the nations to himself than evil reading." That man was Anthony Comstock, who was responsible in 1873 for the passage of the Comstock Act, which, as Mr. Rembar has written, provided the model for most American obscenity statutes for many strenuously imaginative years to come. Obscenity, of course, was only one of Satan's stratagems that had to be smashed. Before the Civil War, for instance, every southern state except Kentucky passed laws controlling and could not bring itself to go quite that far. Into the present, two undeniable, I think, points. One, there are more attempts at censorship, particularly in school libraries, than at any time since the Joe McCarthy, Roy Cohn years. Why not give the living his due? These attacks on books are taking place in 1/5 of the schools of this country. Half of the attempts to expel a book entirely, or remove it from required reading lists, or get it put on a restricted shelf, a new use for the term restrictive covenant, half of these attempts succeed. And the most alarming statistic of all, in nearly 85% of these challenges to books, there is no local newspaper or broadcast coverage. Parents don't know about it. Other members of the community don't know about it. The principal strikes a deal. In the literature of library science, it's called a Zug-Gornish deal. Don't say anything, it never happened. From that keen desire to avoid trouble comes a growing phenomenon. There are reports of it, of its advent from Minnesota, certain parts of New York State, and in the South. Certain authors' new books are no longer ordered by school libraries, no matter what the reviews say, no matter how much interest the kids in the school have shown in that author's work. And one such author is Judy Blume. The second undeniable fact of the current war against books is that much of it is being conducted by the right. The religious right, the political right, the whatever did happen to slavery right. However, when Norman Lear and such virtuous folk make this point, Cal Thomas, who is a vice president of Moral Majority, delights in making the counterpoint that his censorship troops are being criticized for what in the past 20 years has been done by some feminists, by some liberals, by some black citizens. Just at the right beat, I must say. My own interpretation of this is that this is a change of classes in a high school. Cal Thomas is right. Way through its 11 a.m. service, in which centuries of Jewish, Christian, Islamic, and Hindu writings were expurgated because of
I'm against censorship except for bells. I did leave a message with my service, but I said, "Do not disturb." I'm an actor, and as an actor, I have no problems about censorship, although there are movies that I've appeared in where I was cut. I insist it was not for any message or my acting, but for instance, in The Fixer, which I appeared in almost, they had a picture this long, so unfortunately, what they cut was the exposition so that if you did see the movie, it was kind of hard to realize where the picture was going until about 1/3 through. Years ago, I worked in a nightclub with the great Billie Holiday. She sang a song by Lewis Allen called "Strange Fruit." As she sang it, I will recite it. "Southern trees bear a strange fruit. Blood on the leaves, blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging on the poplar trees. Pastoral scenes of the gallant south, the bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolias sweet and fresh, then the sudden smell of burning flesh.
Here is a fruit for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rot, for the trees to drop. Here is a strange and bitter crop. The Island Trees Board of Education of New York would perhaps decide such a song to be offensive to blacks and ban it. Yet I venture to say the song in some measure brought home the horror of lynching. To say that Bernard Mellum is the fixer which exposes anti-Semitism as offensive to Jews is just as far-fetched. In 1913 in Russia, a Jew, Mendel Bayliss, was charged with the ritual murder, an accusation that has plagued the Jews for centuries. He was accused of murdering a Christian child to use the child's blood to make matzahs for Passover. Only a worldwide protest brought a successful end to this anti-Semitic incident. The story of the fixer is based on this happening. How can an anti-Semitic character be exposed without writing truthfully how he thinks, acts, and speaks? I will read from Bernard Mellum's The Fixer. It was freezing cold, but the wind was down on the Dnieper. There was no ferry, the boatman said. Closed down, closed, shut. He waved his arm as though talking to a foreigner, although Yakov had spoken to him in Russian. That the ferry had stopped running sharpened the fixer's desire to get across the river. He hoped to rent a bed at an inn and wake early to look for work. I'll row you across for a ruble, the boatman said. Too much, Yakov answered, though deadly tired. Which way to the bridge? 6 or 8 versts, a long way for the same thing. A ruble, the fixer groaned. Who's got that much money? You can take it or leave it. It's no easy thing rowing across a dangerous river on a pitch black night. We might both drown. What would I do with my horse? The fixer spoke more to himself. That's none of my business, the boatman. His shoulders like a tree trunk, wearing a shaggy grizzled beard, blew out one full nostril on a rock, then the other. The white of his right eye was streaked with blood. Look, mate, why do you make more trouble than it's worth? Even if I could haul it across, which I can't, the beast will die on you. Doesn't take a long look to see he's on his last legs. Look at him trembling. Listen to him breathing like a gored bull. I was hoping to sell him in Kiev. What fool would buy a bag of old bones? I thought maybe a horse butcher or someone, at least the skin. I say the horse is dead, said the boatman, but you can save a ruble if you're smart. I'll take him for the cost of the trip. It's a bother to me, and I'll be lucky to get 50 kopecks for the carcass, but I'll do you a favor, seeing you're a stranger. He's only given me trouble, the fixer thought. He stepped into the rowboat with his bag of tools, books, and other parcels. The boatman untied the boat, dipped both oars into the water, and they were off. The nag, tethered to a paling, watched from the moonlit shore. Like an old Jew he looks, thought the fixer. The horse whinnied, and when that proved useless, farted loudly. I don't recognize the accent you speak, the boatman said, pulling the oars. It's Russian, but from what province? I've lived in Latvia as well as other places, the fixer muttered. First I thought you were a goddamn Pole, Pan Hoosis, Penny Watsis. The boatman laughed and snickered. Or maybe a motherfucking Jew. Though you're dressed like a Russian, you look more like a German. May the devil destroy them all, excepting yourself and yours, of course. Latvian, said Yakov. Anyway, God save us all from the bloody Jews, the boatman said as he rowed. Those long-nosed, pockmarked, cheating, blood-sucking parasite, they'd rob us of daylight if they could. They foul up earth and air with their body-stinking garlic breaths, and Russia will be done to death by the diseases they spread unless we make an end to it. A Jew's a devil. It's a known fact. And if you ever watch one peel off a stinking boot, you'll see a split hoof, it's true. A split hoof, it's true. I know, for as the Lord is my witness, I saw one with my own eyes. He thought nobody was looking, but I saw his hoof as plain as day. He stared at Yakov with a bloody eye. The fixer's foot itched, but he didn't touch it. Let him talk, he thought, yet he shivered. Day after day, they crap up the motherland, the boatman went on monotonously. And the only way to save ourselves is to wipe them out. I don't mean kill a jid now and then with a blow of the fist or a kick in the head, but wipe them all out, which we've sometimes tried but never done as it should be done. I say we ought to call our menfolk together, armed with guns, knives, pitchforks, clubs, anything that'll kill a Jew. And when the church bells begin to ring, we move on the jiddy quarter, which you can tell by the stink, routing them out of wherever they're hiding, in attics, cellars, rat holes, bashing in their brains, stabbing their herring-filled guts, shooting off their snotty noses. No exception made for the young or old, because if you spare any, they breed like rats, and then the job's to do all over again. And then when we've slaughtered the whole cursed tribe of them, and the same is done in every province throughout Russia, wherever we can smoke them out, though we've got most of them nice and bunched up in the pail, we'll pile up the corpses and soak them with benzene and light fires that people will enjoy all over the world. Then when that's done, we hose the stinking ashes away and divide the rubles and jewels and silver and furs and all the other loot they stole, or give it back to the poor who it rightfully belongs to anyway. You can take my word, the time's not far off when everything I say we will do, because our Lord, who they crucified, wants his rightful revenge. He dropped an oar and crossed himself. Jakob fought an impulse to do the same. His bag of prayer things fell with a plop into the Dnieper and sank like lead.
In their letters, novelists reveal their fondness for the PS. Perhaps the fact that we always have something to add is what makes us novelists, Nathaniel Hawthorne included. Hawthorne was a master of the PS. 2 months before he died, he wrote to James Fields, who was then in 1864 an editor at the Atlantic Monthly. I love the PS Hawthorne attached to that letter. P.S., he wrote, give my kindest regards to Mrs. Fields and tell her that one of my choicest ideal places is her drawing room. Therefore, I seldom visit it. Like any fiction writer, Hawthorne preferred the freedom to imagine the ideal. What we face in censorship is the absence of that freedom to imagine. What we face is a threat to the first act of most imaginative literature. It's my pleasure to be able to read to you from what was, as near as we can tell, the first act of a great novel, and a novel that's been unpopular with censors for 132 years. That's how long ago The Scarlet Letter was published, and it's been on various banned books lists ever since. It fits two of the most prevailing categories of banned books. It can be viewed as unflattering to our country in a period of our history, and it exposes a subject that many people wish didn't exist, a subject at least that some censors don't want younger people being exposed to, namely adultery, which is related, even younger people might guess, to sex. So on two counts, unflattering to Americans and having to do with sex, Nathaniel Hawthorne's The Scarlet Letter is still being censored. It is ironic that a novel, in part, about the self-righteousness of the accusers of the Puritan world should draw the fire of the self-righteous accusers of today. That he should still have enemies among the self-righteous should make Hawthorne in his grave very proud. We writers today should also be proud of the fire we draw from the self-righteous. But we must always be anxious. Senators Bob Doyle and Orrin Hatch and 8 other senators in the Judiciary Committee are seeking, as you know, to reverse the 1973 Supreme Court decision on abortion. They seek thereby to amend the Constitution and return women's rights to the recent dark ages. And the Department of Health and Human Services
The human services part of that department's title should tell us writers that irony is cruel and lives on. This human department, anyway, has proposed a regulation that would require that parents be notified when minors treated in federally financed facilities receive prescription contraceptives. Through its 11 a.m. service, in which centuries of Jewish, Christian, Islamic, and Hindu writings were expurgated because of
I'm against censorship except for bells. I did leave a message with my service, but I said do not disturb. I'm an actor, and as an actor, I have no problems about censorship, although there are movies that I've appeared in where I was cut. I insist it was not for any message or my acting, but for instance, in The Fixer, which I appeared in, almost. They wanted a picture, they had a picture this long, and they wanted a picture this long. So unfortunately, what they cut was the exposition, so that if you did see the movie, it was kind of hard to realize where the picture was going until about one-third through. Years ago, I worked in a nightclub with the great Billie Holiday. She sang a song by Lewis Allen called Strange Fruit. As she sang it, I will recite it. Southern trees bear a strange fruit. Blood on the leaves, blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging on the poplar trees. Pastoral scenes of the gallant south. The bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolias sweet and fresh. Then the sudden smell of burning flesh. Here is a fruit for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rot, for the trees to drop. Here is a strange and bitter crop. The Island Trees Board of Education of New York would perhaps decide such a song to be offensive to blacks and ban it. Yet I venture to say the song in some measure brought home the horror of lynching. To say that Bernard Mellum is the fixer which exposes anti-Semitism as offensive to Jews is just as far-fetched. In 1913 in Russia, a Jew, Mendel Bayliss, was charged with the ritual murder, an accusation that has plagued the Jews for centuries. He was accused of murdering a Christian child to use the child's blood to make matzahs for Passover. Only a worldwide protest brought a successful end to this anti-Semitic incident. The story of the fixer is based on this happening. How can an anti-Semitic character be exposed without writing truthfully how he thinks, acts, and speaks? I will read from Bernard Malamud's The Fixer. It was freezing cold, but the wind was down on the Dnieper. There was no ferry, the boatman said. Closed down, closed, shut. He waved his arm as though talking to a foreigner, although Yakov had spoken to him in Russian. That the ferry had stopped running sharpened the fixer's desire to get across the river. He hoped to rent a bed at an inn and wake early to look for work. I'll row you across for a ruble, the boatman said. Too much, Yakov answered, though deadly tired. Which way to the bridge? 6 or 8 versts, a long way for the same thing. A ruble, the fixer groaned. Who's got that much money? You can take it or leave it. It's no easy thing rowing across a dangerous river on a pitch black night. We might both drown. What would I do with my horse? The fixer spoke more to himself. That's none of my business, the boatman. His shoulders like a tree trunk, and wearing a shaggy grizzled beard, blew out one full nostril on a rock, then the other. The white of his right eye was streaked with blood. Look, mate, why do you make more trouble than it's worth? Even if I could haul it across, which I can't, the beast will die on you. Doesn't take a long look to see he's on his last legs. Look at him trembling. Listen to him breathing like a gored bull. I was hoping to sell him in Kiev. What fool would buy a bag of old bones? I thought maybe a horse butcher or someone, at least the skin. I say the horse is dead, said the boatman. But you can save a ruble if you're smart. I'll take him for the cost of the trip. It's a bother to me, and I'll be lucky to get 50 kopecks for the carcass, but I'll do you a favor, seeing you're a stranger. He's only given me trouble, the fixer thought. He stepped into the rowboat with his bag of tools, books, and other parcels. The boatman untied the boat, dipped both oars into the water, and they were off. The nag, tethered to a paling, watched from the moonlit shore. Like an old Jew he looks, thought the fixer. The horse whinnied, and when that proved useless, farted loudly. I don't recognize the accent you speak, the boatman said, pulling the oars. It's Russian, but from what province? I've lived in Latvia as well as other places, the fixer muttered. First I thought you were a goddamn Pole. Pan who's-us, Penny what's-us? The boatman laughed and snickered. Or maybe a motherfucking Jew. Though you're dressed like a Russian, you look more like a German. May the devil destroy them all, excepting yourself and yours, of course. Latvian, said Yakov. Anyway, God save us all from the bloody Jews, the boatman said as he rowed. Those long-nosed, pockmarked, cheating, blood-sucking parasites, they'd rob us of daylight if they could. They foul up earth and air with their body-stinking garlic breaths, and Russia will be done to death by the diseases they spread unless we make an end to it. A Jew's a devil. It's a known fact. And if you ever watch one peel off a stinking boot, you'll see a split hoof, it's true. A split hoof, it's true. I know for as the Lord is my witness, I saw one with my own eyes. He thought nobody was looking, but I saw his hoof as plain as day. He stared at Yakov with a bloody eye. The fixer's foot itched, but he didn't touch it. Let him talk, he thought, yet he shivered. Day after day, they crap up the motherland, the boatman went on monotonously. And the only way to save ourselves is to wipe them out. I don't mean kill a jid now and then with a blow of the fist or a kick in the head, but wipe them all out, which we've sometimes tried but never done as it should be done. I say we ought to call our menfolk together, armed with guns, knives, pitchforks, clubs, anything that'll kill a Jew. And when the church bells begin to ring, we move on the jiddy quarter, which you can tell by the stink, routing them out of wherever they're hiding, in attics, cellars, rat holes, bashing in their brains, stabbing their herring-filled guts, shooting off their snotty noses. No exception made for the young or old, because if you spare any, they breed like rats, and then the job's to do all over again. And then when we've slaughtered the whole cursed tribe of them, and the same is done in every province throughout Russia, wherever we can smoke them out, though we've got most of them nice and bunched up in the pail, we'll pile up the corpses and soak them with benzene and light fires that people will enjoy all over the world. Then when that's done, we hose the stinking ashes away and divide the rubles and jewels and silver and furs and all the other loot they stole, or give it back to the poor who it rightfully belongs to anyway. You can take my word, the time's not far off when everything I say we will do, because our Lord, who they crucified, wants his rightful revenge. He dropped an oar and crossed himself. Yakov fought an impulse to do the same. His bag of prayer things fell with a plop into the Dnieper and sank like lead.
Fields, who was then in 1864 an editor at the Atlantic Monthly. I love the P.S. Hawthorne attached to that letter. P.S., he wrote, give my kindest regards to Mrs. Fields and tell her that one of my choicest ideal places is her drawing room. Therefore, I seldom visit it. Like any fiction writer, Hawthorne preferred the freedom to imagine the ideal. What we face in censorship is the absence of that freedom to imagine. What we face is a threat to the first act of most imaginative literature. It's my pleasure to be able to read to you from what was, as near as we can tell, the first act of a great novel, and a novel that's been unpopular with censors for 132 years. That's how long ago The Scarlet Letter was published, and it's been on various banned books lists ever since. It fits two of the most prevailing categories of banned books. It can be viewed as unflattering to our country in a period of our history, and it exposes a subject that many people wish didn't exist, a subject at least that some censors don't want younger people being exposed to, namely adultery, which is related, even younger people might guess, to sex. So on two counts, unflattering to Americans and having to do with sex, Nathaniel Hawthorne's The Scarlet Letter is still being censored. It is ironic that a novel in part about the self-righteousness of the accusers of the Puritan world should draw the fire of the self-righteous accusers of today. That he should still have enemies among the self-righteous should make Hawthorne in his grave very proud. We writers today should also be proud of the fire we draw from the self-righteous. But we must always be anxious. Senators Bob Doyle and Orrin Hatch and eight other senators in the Judiciary Committee are seeking, as you know, to reverse the 1973 Supreme Court decision on abortion. They seek thereby to amend the Constitution and return women's rights to the recent dark ages. And the Department of Health and Human Services, the human services part of that department's title, should tell us writers that irony is cruel and lives on. This human department, anyway, has proposed a regulation that would require that parents be notified when minors treated in federally financed facilities receive prescription contraceptives. In other words, Hutchinson for what was then called heresy, for becoming the victim of such harsh and presumptuous judgment. Hawthorne called Anne Hutchinson a saint. We should recall the vision Malcolm Cowley had of Hawthorne as one of the loneliest authors who ever wrote, even in this country of lost souls, while at the same time his style was that of a social man, eager to make himself clear and intensely conscious of his audience. Another Hawthorne scholar points out that The Scarlet Letter is not a realistic novel, but a romance, a highly stylized symbolic fable, and only in its moral significance is it firmly linked with the world we inhabit. Of course, that moral significance is the most valuable link literature maintains with the world we inhabit, and why we must defend literature always against the thug art of censorship. The very short passage from Hawthorne I want to read is actually from the story Endicott and the Red Cross, written in 1837. It describes a typical Puritan midday in the shadow of that humorless house of prayer.
Were anti-American, anti-Christian, anti-Semitic, and just plain filthy. I'm bemused by the word filthy in this context, but I even more by the word plain. To the mind of the censor, professional or amateur, all filth, all immorality, or all heresy for that matter, is linguistically plain, self-evident, unmistakable. The psychic and philosophical origins of such a conviction lie in a desperate kind of nominalism, a besieged process of reification by which words are mistaken for things or are made into them. This malady is at the heart of book burning and is what we have to fight. Here on stage, who was clearly a prostitute, but you couldn't use the word prostitute. To such mind, the letter kills. Naturally, we believe it gives life. Thank you.
Good evening. I want to apologize. I'm up here first because I have to run away. There's another meeting tonight of an anti-nuclear group, and I'm going to read a selection up there from a book that, unless this goes really well, will definitely be on the hit list next year. It's Jonathan Schell's book, The Future of the World. I chose Ray Bradbury because I'd never read a work of science fiction. After I finished reading the book, I had a very short and a wonderful dream. I was passing a beautiful old bookshop and an antique shop, and I said out to a lot of people, consider the wonder and the joy of reading books. And then I looked at an old chest and I said, consider the wonders of that beautiful chest and all the books inside. And then I looked at an old table and I said, consider the joy of eating and food for thought. And a voice shouted at me, yes, yes, but consider the cost. And rollicking with laughter, I shouted back and said, yes, yes, but just consider, you only have one life to live. This is from Ray Bradbury. About 2 years ago, a letter arrived from a solemn young Vassar lady telling me how much she enjoyed reading my experiment in space mythology, The Martian Chronicles. But she added, wouldn't it be a good idea this late in time to rewrite the book, inserting more women's characters and roles? A few years before that, I got a certain amount of mail concerning the same Martian book, complaining that the blacks in the book were Uncle Tom's, and why didn't I do them over? Along about then came a note from a Southern white suggesting that I was prejudiced in favor of the blacks and the entire story should be dropped. 2 weeks ago, my mountain of mail delivered forth a pipsqueak mouse of a letter from a well-known publishing house that wanted to reprint my story, The Foghorn, in a high school reader. In my story, I had described a lighthouse as having late at night an illumination coming from it that was a godlight. Looking up at it from the viewpoint of any sea creature, one would have felt that one was in the presence. The editors had deleted godlight and in the presence. Some 5 years back, the editors of yet another anthology for school readers put together a volume with some 400 count 'em short stories in it. How do you cram 400 short stories by Twain, Irving, Poe, Maupassant, and Bierce into one book? Simplicity itself. Skin, debone, demarrow, scarify, melt, render down, and destroy. Every adjective that counted, every verb that moved, every metaphor that weighed more than a mosquito, out. Every simile that would have made a submoron's mouth twitch, gone. Any aside that explained the two-bit philosophy of a first-rate writer, lost. Every story, slenderized, starved, blue-penciled, leached, and bled white, resembled every other story. Twain read like Poe, read like Shakespeare, read like Dostoevsky, read like in the finale, Edgar Guest. Every word of more than three syllables had been razored, every image that demanded so much as one instant's attention, shot dead. Do you begin to get the damned and incredible picture? How did I react? To all of the above, by firing the whole lot, by sending rejection slips to each and every one, by ticketing the assembly of idiots to the far reaches of hell. The point is obvious. There is more than one way to burn a book, and the world is full of people running about with lit matches. Every minority, be it Baptist, Unitarian, Irish, Italian, octogenarian, Zen, Buddhist, Zionist, Seventh-day Adventist, Women's Lib, Republican, Mattachine, Foursquare Gospel feels it has the will, the right, the duty to douse the kerosene, light the fuse. Every dimwit editor who sees himself as the source of all dreary, blank, mange, plain, porridge, unleavened literature licks his guillotine and eyes the neck of any author who dares to speak above a whisper or write above a nursery rhyme. Fire Captain Beatty, in my novel, Fahrenheit 451, described how the book... Fire! That's a sign from God. Fire Captain Beatty. Fire Captain Beatty. Fire Captain Beatty, in my novel, Fahrenheit 451, described how the books were burned, first by minorities, until each ripping a page or a paragraph from this book, then that, until the day came when the books were empty and the minds shut and the libraries closed forever. Shut the door, they're coming through the window. Shut the window, they're coming through the door, are the words to an old song. They fit my lifestyle with newly arriving butcher censors every month. Only 6 weeks ago, I discovered that over the years, some cubbyhole editors at Ballantine Books, fearful of contaminating the young, had bit by bit censored some 75 separate sections from the novel. Students reading the novel, which after all deals with censorship and book burning in the future, wrote to tell me of this exquisite irony. A final test for old Job 2 here. I sent a play, Leviathan 99, off to a university theater a month ago. My play is based on the Moby Dick mythology. Someone is trying to tell us something. Dedicated to Melville and concerns a rocket crew and a blind space comet and destroy the destroyer. My drama premieres as an opera in Paris this autumn, but for now, The university wrote back that they hardly dared do my play. It had no women in it. And the ERA ladies on campus would descend with ball bats if the drama department even tried. Grinding my bicuspids into powder, I suggested that that would mean from now on, no more productions of Boys in the Band, no women, or The Women, no men, or Counting Heads, male and female, a good lot of Shakespeare that would never be seen again, especially if you count lines and find that all the good stuff went to the males. I wrote back, maybe they should do my play one week and the women the next. They probably thought I was joking, and I'm not sure that I wasn't. For it is a mad world, and it will get madder if we allow the minorities, be they dwarf or giant, orangutan or dolphin, nuclear head or water conservationist, pro-computerologist or neo-Luddite, simpleton or sage, to interfere with aesthetics. The real world is the playing ground for each and every group to make or unmake laws. But the tip of the nose of my book or stories or poems is where the rights end and my territorial imperatives begin, run, and rule. If Mormons do not like my plays, let them write their own. If the Irish hate my Dublin stories, let them rent typewriters. If teachers and grammar school editors find my jawbreaker sentences shatter their mushmilk teeth, let them eat stale cake dunked in weak tea of their own ungodly manufacture. For let's face it, digression is the soul of wit. Take philosophic asides away from Dante, Milton, or Hamlet's father's ghost, and what stays is dry bones. Lawrence Stern said it once, digressions incontestably are the sunshine, the life, the soul of reading. Take them out, and one cold eternal winter would reign in every page. Restore them to the writer. He steps forth like a bridegroom, bids all hail, brings in variety, and forbids the appetite to fail. In sum, do not insult me with the beheadings, finger choppings, or the lung deflations you plan for my works. I need my head to shake or nod, my hand to wave or make into a fist, my lungs to shout or whisper with. I will not go gently unto a shelf, degutted to become a non-book. All you umpires, back to the bleachers. Referees, hit the shower. It's my game. I pitch, I hit, I catch, I run the bases. At sunset, I've won or lost. At sunrise, I'm out again, giving it the old try. And no one can help me. Not even you. Thank you.
I'm proud to represent tonight the Treasury of American Poetry, which had the misfortune to carry a poem of mine, Getting Down to Get Over, and a poem by Allen Ginsberg, Howl, on the basis of which the good people in Gretna, Virginia, saw fit to remove the Treasury of American Poetry. So I'd like to read tonight this poem, Getting Down to Get Over, which is dedicated to my mother and which I wrote 10 years ago, and which is tonight dedicated to the people in Gretna, Virginia. The poem goes like this. Mama, 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 mammy, nanny, granny, woman, sister, love, black girl, slave girl, gal, honey child, sweet stuff, sugar, sweetheart, baby, 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 mama, mama, black bitch, black pussy, piece of tail, nice piece of ass. Hey, daddy. Hey, bro. We walk together and talk together and dance and do together, dance and do. Hey, daddy. Hey, bro. Hey, Nina, Nikki, Noni, Nomo, Nomo, mama, black mama. black woman, black female head of household, black matriarchal matriarchy, black statistical, low life, low level, low down, and up to be black statistical, a low factor, factotum, factitious, fictitious, figment, figuring in low down, lying annual reports. Black woman, black, hallelujah, saintly, patient, smiling, humble, giving thanks for annual reports and monthly dole and Friday night and good God, Monday morning, black and female, martyr masochist, a big white lie, mama, mama. What does motherfucking mean? Who's the motherfucker? Fuck my mama, messed yours over, and right now be tripping on my starved black female soul, a Mack truck motherfucker. The first primordial, the paradigmatic, dogmatistic motherfucker. Who is he? Hey, mama, 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 mama. Dry eyes on the shy, dark, hidden, crying black face of the loneliness, the rape, the broke up mailbox, and no Western Union roses come inside the kitchen, and no poem take you through the whole night, and no big black burly hand beholding yours to have to hold on to, no big black burly hand, no, no more, no black prince come riding from the darkness on a beautiful black horse, no bro, no daddy. I was 16 when I met my father in a bar in Baltimore. He told me who he was and what he does, paid for the drinks. I looked, I listened, and I left him. It was civil perfectly and absolute bullshit. The drinks was leaking water weak and never got down to my knees. Hey, Daddy, what they been and done to you and what you been and done to me too, mama, mama, mama. Hey, sugar daddy, big daddy, sweet daddy, black daddy, the original father divine, the ever-loving deep, tall, bad, buck, jive, cold, strut, bop, split, tight, loose, close, hot, 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 sweet, sweet daddy, where you been and when you coming back to me? Hey, when you coming back to mama, 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 mama? And suppose he finally say, look, baby, I loves me some everything about you. Let me be your man. That reach around the hurting like a dream, and I ain't never waking up from that one. Mama, 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 mama. Consider the queen, hand on her hip, sweat resting from the corn bean greensfield, steamy under the pale, sly, suffocating sun. Consider the queen. She fixed the cufflinks on his Sunday shirt and fry some chicken, bake some cake, and tell the family, never mind about the boss man, don't know how a human being's supposed to act. Just never mind about him. Wash your face, sit down, and let the good Lord bless this table. Consider the queen. Her baby's pulling at the nipples, pulling at the mama milk. The infant fingers gingerly approach, caress the soft black swollen mama breast. And there, inside the mama soft, life's spilling treasure chest, the heart breaks, rage by grief, by sorrow, weary, weary, breaks, breaks, quiet, silently, the weary sorrow, quiet now, the furious, the adamant, the broken, busted, beaten down and beaten up, the beaten, 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 weary heart beats tender, steady, and the babies suck. The seed of blood and love glows at the soft black swollen mama breast. Consider the queen. She works when she works in the laundry, in jail, in the schoolhouse, in jail, in the office, in jail, on the soapbox, in jail, on the desk, on the floor, on the street, on the line, at the door, looking fine at the head of the line, stepping sharp from behind in the light with a song, wearing boots or a belt and a gun, drinking wine when it's time, when the long week is done. But she works when she works in the laundry, in jail. She works when she works. Consider the queen. She sleeps when she sleeps with the king in the kingdom. She sleeps when she sleeps with the wall, with whatever it is who happens to call, with me and with you. To survive, you make do, you explore more and more. So she sleeps when she sleeps, a really deep sleep. Consider the queen. A full black glorious, a purple rose aroused by the tiger breathing beside her, a shell with the moaning of ages inside her, a hungry one feeding the folk what they need. consider the queen. Mama, 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 family face, face of the family alive. Mama, mammy, mama, woman, sister, baby, love. The house on fire, poison waters, earthquake, and the air a nightmare. Turn, turn, turn around the national gross product growing really gross. Turn, turn, turn the pestilence away, the miserable killers in Canarsie, Alabama. People begging to be people, warfare on the welfare of the folk. Hey, turn, turn away the trick bag university, the trick bag propaganda, trick bag tricklings.
Shoot the fucker down, man. Just shoot him down. It ain't gonna be easy, Tracy said. Look, Cab said, slinging his M16. The RTO calls him down, and when he comes in, calls him down, we light him up. It's as simple as that. Bam! Another chopper gone, man, and that's all it is. What happens when they find him shot to shit with M16 and M60 rounds? Trowell asked from the back of the group. I've got two AKs broken down at the fire base. Next sweep will just take them along. There was a long, heavy silence, broken only by the sporadic crack of a distant sniper round. What about the first sergeant? Trummer asked. He's out here, man. He ain't anywhere else. You don't see him sitting in Saigon getting fat. Don't worry. When the chopper goes down, he ain't going to be running over to see who's left to save. Okay. Kollowitz said, getting up from where he was squatting. We'll kill him, but only this one. That's it. No more. What about the chopper pilot? Someone asked from the back of the group. He's got to go, too. You know who he was, the trooper asked. One of the guys back at the TOC told me the McGreever's flying the old man now. He ain't got long till his D-Rose. That's tough, man, but you can't shoot down half a chopper. I ain't for killing McGreever, Trowell said. Me either, Johnson said, slamming his weapon closed. He brought us in those 50s that night, man, and he didn't have to do it. Count me out, Trowell said defensively. I ain't killing McGreever just to grease some fucking lieutenant colonel. Me neither, Tracy said, taking off his helmet and licking the salt off his lips. He flew dust-offs, too, someone else offered. Count me out, another trooper said, nervously fingering the safety on his weapon. Me, too. Me, either.
As you can see, writers of all kinds are very concerned with censorship. I think Native Americans are particularly concerned with censorship for several reasons. Let's recall that it was not too many centuries ago that we invited in late November a bunch of people to dinner. And immediately thereafter, all the historians present decided to claim that we weren't the hosts and they weren't the guests. So it's been downhill for us ever since then. I think the point really to be made about censorship from the Native American standpoint is the fact that from the perspective of the many cultures that make up Native American mentality, the notion that one truth is good for everyone just doesn't work. And behind censorship is implied this notion. I think this becomes a bit clearer when we begin to realize that in the Native American view, there is no such thing as a universe, that we live instead in a multiverse, in which there are many ways of understanding the events and circumstances that we find around us. In the process of trying to assimilate Native Americans into the greater dominant culture, this notion of the heterogeneous nature of truth had to be submerged, because you can't get people to believe in your God and your notion of good and evil and beauty and ugliness unless they first agree that they are wrong and you are right. And of course, censors attempt to convince us of this. The censors that we face were called missionaries rather than librarians, but the end result was pretty much the same. We begin to confuse equality and conformity. We begin to think that all of us must agree upon ideas in order to live in peace. In 1934, or until 1934, and the Reorganization Act, Native Americans were effectively censored out of existence by a federal viewpoint which prohibited the speaking of Native languages, the teaching of Native languages, the painting of any ceremonies or dances, the performance of such religious acts, or the wearing of the regalia, which is central to the ceremonies, religious and otherwise, of Native people. We diminish ourselves when we believe that we must teach them, other people, a truth which exists for us, which may not work, nor be a rational, nor an imaginative part of the world of other people. Laughing Boy was written in and published in 1929 by a non-Indian gentleman by the name of Oliver Lafarge, who was born and raised in New England and trained at Harvard and spent a great deal of his time on the Navajo reservation in the north central part of Arizona. The novel is extremely sympathetic and extremely romantic. It was awarded the Pulitzer Prize in 1930. It represents, for I guess some critics, a difficult and frightening aspect of our world, although in reading the book I wasn't able to comprehend why. But I would imagine that since Native Americans have spent about 50 years watching John Wayne, that it wouldn't hurt anybody to read Laughing Boy too much. The book was banned by the Island Tree School District by the Board of Education there in November 1975. On July 28, 1978, it was reinstated. And for those of you who aren't easily shocked by trifles, let me point out to you that in this brief section I'm going to read, there is some indirect reference to prostitution. Outside was the rhythmic thump, thump, thump of a weaver pounding down the threads of her loom. A distant child laugh, someone was chopping wood, sounds of domesticity. I have been thinking about a wife. Well, you are old enough, it is a good thing. He finished his cigarette. You know that slim girl, the one who wears so much hard goods? She danced the first two nights. She is a schoolgirl. She was taken away to that place for 6 years. That is all right. I like her. That is not all right. I do not know how she came to be allowed to dance. They made her stop. Water singer let her dance, but we stopped him. She is bad. She lives down by the railroad. She is not of the people anymore. She is American. She does bad things for the Americans. I do not know what you mean, but I know her. She is not bad. She is good. She is strong, and she is for me. You come away from way up there. You don't know about these things, nor do you know her. What is her clan? I do not know. Well, and what makes you think you can go out and pick a wife for yourself like this? The next thing I know, you will jump into the fire. I tell you, she is all bad for two bits. she will do the worst thing. I'm asked to announce that the intermission will only be 5 minutes and that posters are on sale immediately outside the theater in the lobby.
I am.
I'm sorry to have to tell you that Studs Terkel was not able to make it tonight. He's been banned or censored by a snowstorm in Chicago. In Studs Terkel's place, it gives me pleasure to introduce to you now Thomas Patrick Gates, who was or is the fireman in Terkel's book, Working. Mr. Gates is now the Sergeant-at-Arms of the Uniform Firefighters Association of New York. Mr. Gates.
I'd rather be in a fire now than be standing up here. When those bells went off before, I wanted to bail out of here. City cops, they got clubs. They think they are the elite. Housing authority, they call us the ha-ha cops. Transit cops are called cave cops because they are in the subway. These are little ribs they give. Who's better? Who's New York's finest? I was in a park 3 years ago with a transit cop. We were with these two nice-looking girls. I was still single. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning. We had a couple of six-packs and a pizza pie. We're trying to make out, right? Cops pull up, city cops, and they shine a light on us. So my friend shows the cop his badge. The cop says, that's more of the reason you shouldn't be here. You were fucking on a job. Just get the fuck out of the park. Because he was a transit cop that gave him a hard time. My friend was going after this cop, and this cop was going after him. I grabbed him, and the driver in a police car grabbed his buddy, and they were yelling, keep out of the park. And the other guy yelling, don't come down in the subways. I could have turned around and said, don't ever come into housing projects. It was stupid shit. A guy pulled out a gun and get killed. I don't think it's funny because this kind of mentality is the leaders of this country, but they don't play with 38s. They play with atomic bombs and neutron bombs. What led me to be a cop? I'm not that smart to be a lawyer. A good day in school for me was when a teacher didn't call on me. I used to sit down in the back of the room and slide down into the seat so she didn't call on me. When I got pimples on my face, that made it worse. I was shy. You know, I got glasses here. I was shy. This book was written 10 years ago. I was shy with girls. One thing I told my father, I'm gonna kill myself. I got pimples. He said, I'll never forget it. The world's bigger than a pimple on your face. At that time, I didn't think it was. I used to pile Noxzema on my face, and I was with a girl making out, and she'd say, I smell Noxzema. It used to be in my hair, up my nose. And when I smell Noxzema today, I could still see her face. I like mathematics. I could add like a bastard. I started getting into algebra, but then I got lost. I didn't want to raise my hand because I had the skin problem. It's crazy, right? I sunk down and the teacher never called on me for 2 years. And when she did call on me, it was just to leave the room. I didn't want to be a cop. Money comes into it. I was 26 and I worked in a post office and I wasn't making money, $2.18 an hour. I was young and I wanted to go out with the girls and I wanted to go down to the Jersey Shore. I wanted to buy a car. I just got out of the army. That's why I took it. When I became a cop, I thought I was going against my father. Cops are tools of the shit in Rockefeller. Cops can't understand when they build a new office building in Harlem. The people in our community want a hospital or a school. Rockefeller built that office building, right? Built by white construction workers, and these people demonstrate. Suppose they built in this neighborhood a state office building, and black people built it, and black people worked in it. The cops go in and break up the demonstrators. And who gets it? The cops. Rockefeller's a million miles away. Cops are working, guys. They don't understand. Know why I switched to firemen? I like people. But sometimes I feel hate coming into me. I hated it to get me like that. I took the fire department test in 68 and got called in 70. I always wanted to be a fireman. My older brother was a fireman 11 years. He had a fire and the floor gave way. He was telling me the story. He thought it was just a one floor drop, but the guys grabbed him by the arms. They said, if you go, Billy, we all go. He couldn't believe this kind of comradeship. They pulled him out. He went down to get his helmet. It was two floors down. He really would have got busted up. I like everybody working together. You chipping for a meal together. One guy goes to the store, one guy cooks, one guy washes the dishes. A common goal. We got a lieutenant there. He says the fire department is the closest thing to socialism there is. The officer is the first one into the fire. When you get to be a lieutenant or captain, you get more work, not less. That's why I look up to these guys. We go to a fire, the lieutenant is the first one in. When I was in the Army, I didn't respect the officers because the men did all the work. That goes for the police department too. Cops get killed. You never see a lieutenant get shot. The last three guys in a fire department were lieutenants that got killed because they are the first ones in there. I respect that. I want to respect an officer. I want to see somebody higher up that I can follow. I was in a fire one night. We had an all-hands fire. And all-hands is you got to work in fire and you're the first one in there. And the first guy in there is going to take the worst beating. You got the nozzle, the hose, you are taking a beating. If another company comes up behind you, you don't give up that nozzle. It's pride to put out a fire. We go over this with oxygen, tell the guy, get out, get oxygen. They won't leave. I think guys want to be heroes. You can't be a hero on Wall Street. These guys with black shit coming out of their ears, their noses, you got smoke in your hair. You can take a shower, you put your water on your hair and you can still smell the smoke. It never leaves you. You are coughing up this black shit, but you go back and you have coffee, maybe a couple of beers. You are psyched up. You get a fire, 2-3 in the morning. The lights go on, you get up. I yell, Jesus, what's the matter? Dawn on me. Where else could we be going? All the lights going on, it's dark, it's fucking exciting. Guys are telling, come on, we go, we're first through. That means you gotta be the first engine company there. You really gotta move. It's pride, you gotta show you're the best. But what they are fighting over is good. What they are fighting over is saving lives. About 2 years ago, a young girl ran into the firehouse. She's yelling that her father had a heart attack. The guy was laying in the kitchen, right? He pissed in his pants, that's a sign of death. The fellow was lying there with his eyes open. Jimmy Finizzi pushes the guy 3 times in his chest because you got to shock his heart. The son was standing in the room just staring down. Go down on his mouth. You keep going and going. The guy threw up. You clean out his mouth. I was on a few minutes. Then Danny Gorman jumped on the guy's mouth. The captain bent down and said, the guy's dead. Keep going for the family. Do it for the family. We took over 10 minutes, but it was a dead man. The son looked down at me and I looked up. He said, man, you tried everything. You tried. You know what I mean? I was proud of myself. I would gonna go down on a stranger, on his mouth. It's a great feeling. We had this fire down a block, a Puerto Rican social club. The captain and the other fireman took the ladder up and saved 2 people. But downstairs, there was a guy trying to get out the back door. They had bolts on the door. He was burnt dead. His fingernails had rotted down from trying to scrape his way out. Know what the lieutenant said? We lost a guy. I said, you saved two people. How would you know at 6 in the morning, a guy in a social club sleeping on a pool table? He said, yeah, but we lost a guy. You get guys that talk about niggas, spicks, and they're the first ones into the fire to save them. Of course we got guys with long hair and beards. One guy's an artist. His brother was killed in Vietnam, Jimmy Riley. That's why he's against the war. And these guys are all super firemen. It's you that takes the beating, and you won't give up. My wife sees television. Guys get killed. She tells me, be careful. Sometimes she call up the firehouse. I tell her we had a bad job. Sometimes I don't. They got a saying in a firehouse, tonight could be tonight. But nobody thinks of dying. You can't take it seriously because you get sick. We had some fires. I said, we're not going to get out of this. Like I say, everybody dies. A lot of guys want to be firemen. It's like kids. Guys 40 years old are kids. They try to be a hard guy. There's no big thing when you leave boyhood for manhood. It seems like I talk the same at 15 as I talk now. Everybody's still a kid. They just lose their hair or they don't fuck that much. I take that back. That was 10 years ago. When I was a kid, I was scared of heights. In a fire department, you gotta go up a 5-story building with a rope around you. You gotta jump off a building. You know the rope can hold 1,600 pounds as long as you got confidence in your body and you know the guy's holding you. You got nothing to be scared of. I think you perform with people looking at you. You're in the limelight. You're out there with the people and kids. Kids wave at you. When I was a kid, we waved at firemen. It's like a place in the sun. Last month, there was a second alarm. I was off duty. I ran over there. I'm a bystander. I see these firemen on the roof with the smoke pouring out around them and the flames, and they go in. It fascinated me. Jesus Christ, that's what I do. I was fascinated by the people's faces. You could see the pride that they were seeing. The fucking world's fucked up. The country's fucked up. But the firemen, you actually see them produce. You see them put out a fire. You see them come out with the babies in their hands. You see them get mouth to mouth when a guy's dying. You can't get around that shit. That's real. To me, that's what I want to be. I worked in a bank, you know? It's just paper. It's not real. 9 to 5 and it's shit. You're looking at numbers, but I can look back and say, I helped put out a fire. I helped save somebody. It shows something I did on this earth. I want to say something about four-letter words. I have been a New York City firefighter for 12 years. It was a great honor to see my name printed in Studs Terkel's book. In 1979, I was elected by the firefighters of this city as Sergeant-at-Arms of the Uniformed Firefighters Association, the largest local union of firefighters in the United States, Canada, and the state of Georgia. To see my name printed in a book made this nobody feel like somebody. And now this somebody represents the working class heroes of this city, the New York City firefighters. On August 2nd, 1978, I was on vacation. I was walking along a country road with my kids. My father came running out of the house screaming that 6 firemen were killed in a fire in Brooklyn. The roof collapsed, sending them into the flames. What was left was buckles and badges and 16 kids without a daddy. I turned around, went into the house, took off my clothes, and turned on a shower. I did not shout, damn it, damn it, damn it. I said, fuck, 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 and it made me feel better.
Company of so many illustrious writers whom I read and dearly love. In 1975, in this infamous Island Trees district in New York, a book called A Reader for Writers was banned because of 2 essays contained therein, one by Robert Penn Warren, which made reference to Malcolm X, the other by Jonathan Swift, the author of Gulliver's Travels, which you obviously know, was born in Dublin of Irish parents, and published this essay in October of 1729, 253 years ago, before he wrote Gulliver's Travels. And it's from that essay that I'd like to read now. A modest proposal for preventing the children of poor people from being a burden to their parents or the country, and for making them beneficial to the public. It is a melancholy object to those who walk through this great town of Dublin when they see the streets crowded with beggars of the female sex, followed by 3, 4, or 6 children, all in rags and importuning every passenger for an alms. I think it is agreed by all parties that this prodigious number of children in the arms or on the backs or at the heels of their mothers and frequently of their fathers is, in the present deplorable state of the kingdom, a very great additional grievance, and therefore, whoever could find out a fair, cheap, and easy method of making these children sound and useful members of the Commonwealth would deserve so well of the public as to have his statue set up for a preserver of the nation. Now, I have been assured by a very knowing American of my acquaintance in London that a young, healthy child, well nursed, is at a year old a most delicious, nourishing, and wholesome food. Whether stewed, roasted, baked, or boiled, and I make no doubt that it will equally serve in a fricassee or ragout. I do therefore humbly offer it to public consideration that 100,000 at a year old be offered in sale to the persons of quality and fortune through the kingdom,
always advising the mother to let them suck plentifully in the last month so as to render them plump and fat for a good table. A child will make two dishes at an entertainment for friends, and when the family dines alone, the fore or hind quarter will make a reasonable dish, and seasoned with a little salt or pepper, will be very good boiled on the fourth day, especially in winter. I have reckoned upon a medium that a child just born will weigh 12 pounds, and in a solar year, if tolerably nursed, increaseth to 28 pounds. I believe no gentleman would repine to give 10 shillings for the carcass of a good, fat child. Those who are more thrifty may flay the carcass, the skin of which, artificially dressed, will make admirable gloves for ladies and summer boots for fine gentlemen. As to our city of Dublin, meat markets may be appointed for this purpose in the most convenient parts of it, and butchers, we may be assured, will not be wanting, although I rather recommend buying the children alive and dressing them hot from the knife, as we do roasting pigs. I think the advantages by the proposal which I have made are obvious, and many as well as of the highest importance. It would greatly lessen the number of papists with whom we are yearly overrun. The poorer tenants will have something valuable of their own. The constant breeders, besides the gain of 8 shillings sterling per annum by the sale of their children, will be rid of the charge of maintaining them after the first year. We shall soon see an honest emulation among the married women, which of them could bring the fattest child to market. Men would become as fond of their wives during their time of pregnancy as they are now of their mares in foal or their cows in calf, nor offer to beat or kick them, as it is too frequent a practice, for fear of miscarriage. Pigs, too frequent at our tables, are no way comparable in taste or magnificence to a well-grown, fat, yearling child, which roasted whole will make a considerable figure at a Lord Mayor's feast or any other public entertainment, particularly weddings and christenings. I compute that Dublin would take off annually about 20,000 carcasses, and the rest of the kingdom, where probably they'd be sold somewhat cheaper, the remaining 80,000. I can think of no one objection that will possibly be raised against this proposal, unless it should be urged that the number of people will be thereby much lessened in the kingdom. This I freely own, and it was indeed one principal design in offering it to the world. I desire the than the public good of my country by advancing our trade, providing for infants, relieving the poor, and giving some pleasure to the rich. I have no children by which I can propose to get a single penny, the youngest being 9 years old and my wife past childbearing. I want to remind you once again that you're all invited to a reception in the lobby right now.
run down and get the fifth stair. Take care.
Hutchinson, a saint. We should recall the vision Malcolm Cowley had of Hawthorne as one of the loneliest authors who ever wrote, even in this country of lost souls, while at the same time his style was that of a social man, eager to make himself clear and intensely conscious of his audience. Another Hawthorne scholar points out that The Scarlet Letter is not a realistic novel, but a romance, a highly stylized symbolic fable, and only in its moral significance is it firmly linked with the world we inhabit. Of course, that moral significance is the most valuable link literature maintains with the world we inhabit, and why we must defend literature always against the thug art of censorship. The very short passage from Hawthorne I want to read is actually from the story Endicott and the Red Cross, written in 1837. It describes a typical Puritan midday in the shadow of that humorless house of prayer, much as Bruegel might have painted it. It was, most people agree, the first act of his imagination that led him to write The Scarlet Letter, and it is regularly published today at the conclusion of The Scarlet Letter. A token of the perils of the wilderness was seen in the grim head of a wolf, which had just been slain within the precincts of the town, and according to the regular mode of claiming the bounty, was nailed on the porch of the meeting house. The blood was still plashing on the doorstep. There happened to be visible at the same noon hour so many other characteristics of the times and manners of the Puritans that we must endeavor to present them in a sketch. In close vicinity to the sacred edifice appeared that important engine of Puritanic authority, the whipping post, with the soil around it well trodden by the feet of evildoers who had there been disciplined. At one corner of the meeting house was the pillory, and at the other the stocks, and by singular good fortune for our sketch, the head of an Episcopalian and suspected Catholic was grotesquely encased in the former machine, while a fellow criminal who had boisterously quaffed a health to the king was confined by the legs in the latter. Side by side on the meeting house steps stood a male and a female figure. The man was a tall, lean, haggard personification of fanaticism, bearing on his breast this label, a wanton gospeler, which betokened that he had dared to give interpretations of holy writ unsanctioned by the infallible judgment of the civil and religious rulers. His aspect showed no lack of zeal, even at the stake. The woman wore a cleft stick on her tongue, in appropriate retribution for having wagged that unruly member against the elders of the church, and her countenance and gestures gave much cause to apprehend that the moment the stick should be removed, a repetition of the offense would demand new ingenuity for chastising it. The above-mentioned individuals had been sentenced to undergo their various modes of ignominy for the space of 1 hour at noonday, but among the crowd were several whose punishment would be lifelong. Some whose ears had been cropped like those of puppy dogs, others whose cheeks had been branded with the initials of their misdemeanors, one with his nostrils slit and seared, and another with a halter about his neck which he was forbidden ever to take off or to conceal beneath his garments. I think he must have been grievously tempted to affix the other end of the rope to some convenient beam or bough. There was likewise a young woman with no mean share of beauty, whose doom it was to wear the letter A on the breast of her gown in the eyes of all the world and her own children. And even her own children knew what that initial signified. Sporting with her infamy, the lost and desperate creature had embroidered the fatal token in scarlet cloth with golden thread and the nicest art of needlework, so that the capital A might have been thought to mean admirable, or anything rather than adulterous. But let not the reader argue from any of these evidences of iniquity that the times of the Puritans were more vicious than our own. Who would argue with that?
From The Grapes of Wrath by John Steinbeck, and tell you that it has been removed from the libraries of the city of Kanawha, Iowa, and successfully since 1980, and from the town of Richford, Vermont, which kind of surprised me. It sounded more like New Hampshire would do, but. And proving that it failed. I mean, it's still there. To the red country and part of the gray country of Oklahoma, the last rains came gently, and they did not cut the scarred earth. The plows crossed and recrossed the rivulet marks. The last rains lifted the corn quickly and scattered weed colonies and grass along the sides of the roads, so that the gray country and the dark red country began to disappear under green cover. In the last part of May, the sky grew pale, and the clouds that had hung in high puffs so long in the spring were dissipated. The sun flared down on the growing corn day after day until a line of brown spread along the edge of each green bayonet. The clouds appeared and went away, and in a while they did not try anymore. The weeds grew darker green to protect themselves. The surface of the earth crusted, a thin, hard crust, and as the sky became pale, so the earth became pale, pink in the red country and white in the gray country. In the water-cut gullies, the earth dusted down in dry little streams, and as the sharp sun struck day after day, the leaves of the young corn became less stiff and erect. They bent in a curve at first, and then, as the central ribs of strength grew weak, each leaf tilted downward. Then it was June, and the sun shone more fiercely, and the brown lines on the corn leaves widened and moved in on the central ribs. The weeds frayed and edged back toward their root, and every day the earth paled. In the roads where the teams moved, the hooves of the horses beat on the ground, and the dirt crust broke, the dust formed. Every moving thing lifted the dust into the air. A walking man lifted a thin layer as high as his waist, and the wagon lifted the dust as high as the fence, and an automobile boiled a cloud behind it. When June was half gone, the big clouds moved up out of Texas and the Gulf, high, heavy clouds, rainheads. The men in the fields looked up at the clouds and sniffed at them and held wet fingers up to sense the wind. The rainheads dropped a little spattering and hurried on to some other country. A gentle wind followed the rain clouds, driving them on northward, a wind that softly clashed the drying corn. A day went by, the wind increased, steady, unbroken by gusts. The dust from the roads fluffed up and spread out and fell on the weeds beside the fields, fell into the fields a little way. Now the wind grew strong and hard and worked at the rain crust in the cornfields. Little by little, the sky was darkened by the mixing dust, and the wind fell over the earth, loosened the dust, carried it away. The wind grew stronger. The rain crust broke, and the dust lifted up out of the fields and drove gray plumes into the air. The corn threshed the wind and made a high, dry, rushing sound. The finest dust did not settle back to earth now, but disappeared into the darkening sky. The dawn came, but no day. In the gray sky, a red sun appeared, a dim red circle that gave a little light like dusk. And as that day advanced, the dusk slipped back toward darkness. The wind cried and whimpered over the fallen corn. Men and women huddled in their houses, and they tied handkerchiefs over their noses when they went out and wore goggles to protect their eyes. When the night came again, it was black night, for the stars could not pierce the dust to get down. Now the dust was evenly mixed with the air, an emulsion of dust and air. Houses were shut tight and cloth wedged round the doors and windows, but the dust came in so thinly it could not be seen and settled like pollen on chairs and tables. In the middle of that night, the wind passed and left the land quiet. The dust-filled air muffled sound more completely than fog does. The people lying in their beds heard the wind stop. They lay quietly and listened deeply into the darkness. Then the roosters crowed and their voices were muffled. The people stirred restlessly in their beds and wanted the morning. In the morning, the dust hung like fog. The sun was as red as ripe new blood. All day, the dust sifted down from the sky, and the next day, it sifted down. It settled on the corn, piled up on the tops of the fence posts, piled up on the wires, blanketed the weed and trees. The people came out of their houses and smelled the stinging air and covered their noses. The children came out of the houses, but did not run or shout as they would have done after rain. Men stood by their fences and looked at the ruined corn, drying fast now, only a little green showing through the film of dust. The men were silent and they did not move often. The women came out of their houses to stand beside them, to feel whether this time the men would break. The women studied the men's faces secretly, for the corn could go as long as something else remained. The children stood nearby, drawing figures in the dust with bare toes, and they set exploring senses out to see whether men and women would break. The children peeked at the faces of the men and women and then drew careful lines in the dust with their toes. And then, from then on, begins the great suffering of this people, of our people, as they moved west. And that suffering, the people of Kanawha don't know, they want their children to know about.
That brave new world
The Wizard of Oz by L. Frank Baum was first banned from many public library systems in the 1920s. Most children's librarians felt that the Oz books had nothing of worth to offer to young readers, keeping the books off library shelves throughout the country. In 1957, the director of the Detroit Public Library System banned The Wizard of Oz for encouraging negativism and for generally being of no value. In some cases, controversy over the Oz book centered on its author, L. Frank Baum, who was falsely accused of being a communist. The Wizard of Oz has been reinstated in most public libraries today, but not all. The Wizard of Oz, Chapter 15, The Discovery of Oz, the Terrible. The four travelers, Dorothy, the Scarecrow, the Woodman, and the Lion, walked up to the great gate of the Emerald City and rang the bell. After ringing several times, it was opened by the guardian of the gate. "What? Are you back again?" he asked in surprise. "But I thought you'd gone to visit the Wicked Witch of the West." "Well, we did visit her," said the Scarecrow. "And she let you go again?" asked the man in wonder. "She could not help it. She's melted," explained the Scarecrow. "Melted? Who melted her?" "It was Dorothy," said the Lion gravely. "Good gracious," exclaimed the man, and he bowed very low before her. He then let them pass through the gate into the Emerald City. And when the people heard from the guardian of the gate that they had melted the Wicked Witch of the West, they all gathered around the travelers and followed them in a great crowd to the Palace of Oz. The four travelers passed a sleepless night, thinking of the gift Oz had promised to bestow upon each. Dorothy fell asleep only once, and then she dreamed she was in Kansas, where Aunt Em was so glad to have her little girl back home again. Promptly at 9 o'clock the next morning, they all went into the throne room of the Great Oz. Of course, each one of them expected to see the wizard in the shape he'd taken before, and all were greatly surprised when they looked about and saw no one at all in the room. They kept close to the door and closer to one another, for the stillness of the empty room was more dreadful than any of the forms they had seen Oz take. Presently, they heard a voice, seeming to come straight from the throne itself.
"I am Oz, the great and terrible. Why do you seek me?"
We've come to claim our promise, O Oz," Dorothy said.
"What promise?" asked Oz.
"You promised to send me back to Kansas when the Wicked Witch was destroyed," said the girl.
"And you promised to give me brains," said the Scarecrow.
"And you promised to give me a heart," said the Tin Woodman.
"And you promised to give me courage," said the Cowardly Lion. "Is the Wicked Witch really destroyed?" asked the voice, and Dorothy thought it trembled a little.
"Yes," she answered. "I melted her with a bucket of water."
"Dear me," said the voice. "How sudden. Well, come to me tomorrow, for I must have time to think it over."
"You've had plenty of time already. You must keep your promise to us," claimed Dorothy. The lion thought it might be well to frighten the wizard, so he gave a large, loud roar, so fierce and dreadful that Toto jumped away from him in alarm and tipped over a screen that stood in a corner. As it fell with a crash, they saw a little old man with a bald head and a wrinkled face. The Tin Woodman, raising his axe, rushed to the little man and cried out, "Who are you?"
"I am Oz, the great and terrible," said the little man.
Our friends looked at him in surprise and dismay. "Oh, I thought Oz was a great head," said Dorothy.
"And I thought Oz was a lovely lady," said the Scarecrow.
"And I thought Oz was a terrible beast," said the Tin Woodman.
"And I thought Oz was a ball of fire," said the lion. "No, you are all wrong," said the little man meekly. "I have been making believe."
"Making believe," cried Dorothy. "Are you not a great wizard?"
"Hush, my dear," he said. "Don't speak so loud, or you'll be overheard, and I shall be ruined. I'm supposed to be a great wizard."
"And aren't you?" she asked.
"Not a bit of it, my dear. I'm just a common man." "You're more than that," said the Scarecrow in a grieved tone. "You're a humbug."
"Well, exactly so," declared the little man, rubbing his hand together as if it pleased him.
"I am a humbug."
"Oh, I think you are a very bad man," said Dorothy.
"Oh, no, my dear, I'm really a very good man. I'm just a very bad wizard, I must admit."
"Oh, can't you give me brains?" said the Scarecrow.
You don't need them. You're learning something every day. A baby has brains, but it doesn't know much. Experience is the only thing that brings knowledge, and the longer you are on the earth, the more experience you are sure to get."
"Well, that may be all true," said the Scarecrow, "but I shall be very unhappy unless you give me brains." "Well," said the wizard with a sigh, "I'm not much of a magician, as I said, but if you will come to me tomorrow, I will stuff your head with brains. I cannot tell you how to use them, however. You must find that out for yourself."
"But how about my courage?" said the lion anxiously.
"Well, you have plenty of courage, I'm sure," answered Oz. "All you need is confidence in yourself. There is no living thing that is not afraid when it faces danger. True courage is facing danger when you are afraid. And that kind of courage you have in plenty."
"Oh, perhaps I have, but I'm scared just the same," said the lion. "I shall really be very unhappy unless you give me the sort of courage that makes one forget he's afraid."
"Well, very well. I will give you that sort of courage tomorrow," replied Oz.
"Well, how about my heart?" said the Tin Woodman.
"Well, as for that," answered Oz, "I think you're wrong to want a heart."
A wind followed the rain clouds, driving them on northward, a wind that softly clashed the drying corn. A day went by, the wind increased, steady, unbroken by gusts. The dust from the roads fluffed up and spread out and fell on the weeds beside the fields, fell into the fields a little way. Now the wind grew strong and hard and worked at the rain crust in the cornfields. Little by little, the sky was darkened by the mixing dust, and the wind fell over the earth, loosened the dust, carried it away. The wind grew stronger. The rain crust broke, and the dust lifted up out of the fields and drove gray plumes into the air. The corn threshed the wind and made a high, dry, rushing sound. The finest dust did not settle back to earth now, but disappeared into the darkening sky. The dawn came, but no day. In the gray sky, a red sun appeared, a dim red circle that gave a little light like dusk. And as that day advanced, the dusk slipped back toward darkness. The wind cried and whimpered over the fallen corn. Men and women huddled in their houses, and they tied handkerchiefs over their noses when they went out and wore goggles to protect their eyes. When the night came again, it was black night, for the stars could not pierce the dust to get down. Now the dust was evenly mixed with the air, an emulsion of dust and air. Houses were shut tight and cloth wedged round the doors and windows, but the dust came in so thinly it could not be seen and settled like pollen on chairs and tables. In the middle of that night, the wind passed and left the land quiet. The dust-filled air muffled sound more completely than fog does. The people lying in their beds heard the wind stop. They lay quietly and listened deeply into the darkness. Then the roosters crowed and their voices were muffled. The people stirred restlessly in their beds and wanted the morning. In the morning, the dust hung like fog. The sun was as red as ripe new blood. All day, the dust sifted down from the sky, and the next day, it sifted down. It settled on the corn, piled up on the tops of the fence posts, piled up on the wires, blanketed the weed and trees. The people came out of their houses and smelled the stinging air and covered their noses. The children came out of the houses, but did not run or shout as they would have done after rain. Men stood by their fences and looked at the ruined corn, drying fast now, only a little green showing through the film of dust. The men were silent and they did not move often. The women came out of their houses to stand beside them, to feel whether this time the men would break. The women studied the men's faces secretly, for the corn could go as long as something else remained. The children stood nearby, drawing figures in the dust with bare toes, and they set exploring senses out to see whether men and women would break. The children peeked at the faces of the men and women and then drew careful lines in the dust with their toes. And then, from then on, begins the great suffering of this people, of our people, as they moved west. And that suffering, the people of Kanawha don't know, they want their children to know about.
That brave new world.
The Wizard of Oz by L. Frank Baum was first banned from many public library systems in the 1920s. Most children's librarians felt that the Oz books had nothing of worth to offer to young readers, keeping the books off library shelves throughout the country. In 1957, the director of the Detroit Public Library System banned The Wizard of Oz for encouraging negativism and for generally being of no value. In some cases, controversy over the Oz books centered on its author, L. Frank Baum, who was falsely accused of being a communist. The Wizard of Oz has been reinstated in most public libraries today, but not all. The Wizard of Oz, Chapter 15, The Discovery of Oz, the Terrible. The four travelers, Dorothy, the Scarecrow, the Woodman, and the Lion, walked up to the great gate of the Emerald City and rang the bell. After ringing several times, it was opened by the guardian of the gate. "What? Are you back again?" he asked in surprise. "But I thought you'd gone to visit the Wicked Witch of the West." "Well, we did visit her," said the Scarecrow. "And she let you go again?" asked the man in wonder. "She could not help it. She's melted," explained the Scarecrow. "Melted? Who melted her?" "It was Dorothy," said the Lion gravely.
"Good gracious," exclaimed the man, and he bowed very low before her. He then let them pass through the gate into the Emerald City. And when the people heard from the guardian of the gate that they had melted the Wicked Witch of the West, they all gathered around the travelers and followed them in a great crowd to the Palace of Oz. The four travelers passed a sleepless night, thinking of the gift Oz had promised to bestow upon each. Dorothy fell asleep only once, and then she dreamed she was in Kansas, where Aunt Em was so glad to have her little girl back home again. Promptly at 9 o'clock the next morning, they all went into the throne room of the Great Oz. Of course, each one of them expected to see the wizard in the shape he'd taken before, and all were greatly surprised when they looked about and saw no one at all in the room. They kept close to the door and closer to one another, for the stillness of the empty room was more dreadful than any of the forms they had seen Oz take. Presently, they heard a voice, seeming to come straight from the throne itself.
"I am Oz, the great and terrible. Why do you seek me?"
We've come to claim our promise, O Oz," Dorothy said.
"What promise?" asked Oz.
"You promised to send me back to Kansas when the Wicked Witch was destroyed," said the girl.
"And you promised to give me brains," said the Scarecrow.
"And you promised to give me a heart," said the Tin Woodman.
"And you promised to give me courage," said the Cowardly Lion.
"Is the Wicked Witch really destroyed?" asked the voice, and Dorothy thought it trembled a little. "Yes," she answered. "I melted her with a bucket of water."
"Dear me," said the voice, "how sudden. Well, come to me tomorrow, for I must have time to think it over."
"You've had plenty of time already. You must keep your promise to us," claimed Dorothy. The lion thought it might be well to frighten the wizard, so he gave a large, loud roar, so fierce and dreadful that Toto jumped away from him in alarm and tipped over a screen that stood in a corner. As it fell with a crash, they saw a little old man with a bald head and a wrinkled face. The Tin Woodman, raising his axe, rushed to the little man and cried out, "Who are you?"
"I am Oz, the
terrible," said the little man. Our friends looked at him in surprise and dismay. "Oh, I thought Oz was a great head," said Dorothy.
"And I thought Oz was a lovely lady," said the Scarecrow.
"And I thought Oz was a terrible beast," said the Tin Woodman.
"And I thought Oz was a ball of fire," said the lion.
"No, you are all wrong," said the little man meekly. "I have been making believe."
"Making believe," cried Dorothy. "Are you not a great wizard?"
"Hush, my dear," he said. "Don't speak so loud, or you'll be overheard, and I shall be ruined. I'm supposed to be a great wizard."
"And aren't you?" she asked.
"Not a bit of it, my dear. I'm just a common man." "You're more than that," said the Scarecrow in a grieved tone. "You're a humbug."
"Well, exactly so," declared the little man, rubbing his hand together as if it pleased him.
"I am a humbug." "Well, I think you are a very bad man," said Dorothy.
"Oh, no, my dear. I'm really a very good man. I'm just a very bad wizard, I must admit."
"Well, can't you give me brains?" said the Scarecrow. "You don't need them. You're learning something every day. A baby has brains, but it doesn't know much. Experience is the only thing that brings knowledge, and the longer you are on the earth, the more experience you are sure to get."
"Well, that may be all true," said the Scarecrow, "but I shall be very unhappy unless you give me brains."
"Well," said the wizard with a sigh, "I'm not much of a magician, as I said. But if you will come to me tomorrow, I will stuff your head with brains. I cannot tell you how to use them, however. You must find that out for yourself."
"But how about my courage?" said the lion anxiously.
"Well, you have plenty of courage, I'm sure," answered Oz. "All you need is confidence in yourself. There is no living thing that is not afraid when it faces danger. True courage is facing danger when you are afraid. And that kind of courage you have in plenty."
"Oh, perhaps I have, but I'm scared just the same," said the lion. "I shall really be very unhappy unless you give me the sort of courage that makes one forget he's afraid."
"Well, very well. I will give you that sort of courage tomorrow," replied Oz. How about my heart, said the Tin Woodman.
Well, as for that, answered Oz, I think you're wrong to want a heart.
One thing I ask in return for my help, such as it is, you must keep my secret and tell no one I am a humbug. They agreed to say nothing of what they learned and went back to their rooms in high spirits. Even Dorothy had hoped that the great and terrible humbug, as she called him, would find a way to send her back to Kansas. And if he did that, she was willing to forgive him everything.
Nat Hentoff has told you something of the circumstances and pseudo-reasons surrounding the several bannings of Mark Twain's Huckleberry Finn, various places in the country recently. I would like now merely to give you a reminder of the flavor of the book. Huck and Jim are on the river, on the raft. Huck is speaking. 2 or 3 days and nights went by. I reckon I might say they swum by. They slid around so quiet and smooth and lovely. Here is the way we put in the time. It was a monstrous big river down there, sometimes a mile and a half wide. We run nights and laid up and hid daytimes. Soon as night was most gone, we stopped navigating and tied up, nearly always in the dead water under a towhead. And then cut young cottonwoods and willows and hid the raft with them. Then we set out the lines. Next we slid off into the river and had a swim so as to freshen up and cool off. Then we sat down on the sandy bottom where the water was about knee deep and watched the daylight come. Not a sound anywheres, perfectly still, just like the whole world was asleep. Only sometimes the bullfrogs are cluttering. The first thing to see, looking away over the water, was a kind of dull line. That was the woods on the other side. You couldn't make nothing else out. Then a pale place in the sky, then more paleness spreading around. Then the river softened up away off and weren't black anymore, but gray. You could see little dark spots drifting along ever so far away, trading scows and such things, and long black streaks, rafts. Sometimes you could hear a sweep squeaking or jumbled up voices. It was so still, and the sounds come so far. And by, you could see a streak on the water, which you knew by the look of it, that there's a snag there in a swift current, which breaks on it and makes that streak look that way. And you could see the mist curl up from the river and the east reddening up. And you could make out a log cabin in the edge of the woods, away on the bank on the other side, being a wood yard, likely, and piled up by them sheets so thin you could throw a dog through it anywheres. Then the nice breeze springs up and comes fanning you from over there, so cool and fresh and sweet to smell on account of the woods and flowers, but sometimes not that way.
because they've left dead fish laying around, gars and such, and they do get pretty rank. And next you've got the full day and everything smiling in the sun and the songbirds just going at it. A little smoke couldn't be noticed now, so we would take some fish off the lines and cook up a hot breakfast, and afterwards we would watch the lonesomeness of the river and kind of lazy along, and by, lazy off to sleep. Wake by, and look to see what had done it, and maybe see a steamboat coughing along upstream, so far off toward the other side you couldn't tell nothing about her, only whether she was a stern wheel or a side wheel. Then, for about an hour, there wouldn't be nothing to hear and nothing to see. Just solid lonesomeness. Next, you'd see a raft sliding by, way off yonder, and maybe a galoot on it, chopping, because they're most always doing that on a raft. You'd see the axe flash and come down. You don't hear nothing. You see that axe go up again, and by the time it's above the man's head, then you hear the ka-chunk. It had took all that time to come across the water. So we would put in the day, lazying around, listening to the stillness. Once there was a thick fog, and the rafts and things that went by was beating tin pans so the steamboats wouldn't run over them. A scow or a raft went by so close we could hear them talking and cussing and laughing, hear them plain, but we couldn't see no sign of them. It made you feel crawly. It was like spirits carrying on that way in the air. Jim said he believed it was spirits, but I says no, spirits wouldn't say dern the darn fog. Sometimes we'd have that whole river all to ourselves for the longest time. Yonder was the banks and the islands across the water, and maybe a spark, which was a candle in a cabin window. And sometimes on the water, you could see sparks too, on a raft or a scow. And maybe you could hear a fiddle or a song coming over from one of them craft. It's lovely to live on a raft. We had the sky up there all speckled with stars, and we used to lay on our backs and look up at them and discuss about whether they was made or only just happened. Jim, he allowed they was made, but I allowed they happened. I judged it would have took too long to make so many. Jim said the moon could have laid them like eggs. Well, that looked kind of reasonable, so I didn't say nothing against it, because I've seen a frog lay most as many. So, of course, it could be done. We used to watch the stars that fell, too, and see them streak down. Jim allowed they'd got spoiled and was hove out of the nest. It's lovely to live on a raft. Thank you.
This book probably isn't quite as well known to you as some, certainly not as well known as Huckleberry Finn or Mary Poppins.
The weary tones of a distant bugle blown upon still midnight air. In the mirror, I could see Mr. Norton staring out vacantly upon the empty fields, his mouth stern, his white forehead livid where it had scraped the screen. And seeing him, I felt the fear balled coldly within me unfold. What would happen now? What would the school officials say? In my mind, I visualized Dr. Bledsoe's face when he saw Mr. Norton. I thought of the glee certain folks at home would feel if I were expelled. Tatlock's grinning face danced through my mind. What would the white folks think who'd sent me to college? Was Mr. Norton angry at me? In the golden day, he had seemed more curious than anything else, until the vet had started talking wild. Damn true blood. It was his fault. If we hadn't sat in the sun so long, Mr. Norton would not have needed whiskey, and I wouldn't have gone to the golden day. And why would the vets act that way with a white man in the house? I headed the car through the red brick camp escape posts, with a sense of cold apprehension. Now even the rows of neat dormitories seemed to threaten me. The rolling lawns appeared as hostile as the gray highway with its white dividing line. As of its own compulsion, the car slowed as we passed the chapel with its low, sweeping eaves. The sun shone coolly through the avenue of trees, dappling the curving drive. Students strolled through the shade, down a hill of tender grass toward the brick-red stretch of tennis courts. Far beyond, players in whites showed sharp against the red of the court surrounded by grass, a gay vista washed by the sun. In the brief interval, I heard a cheer arise. My predicament struck me like a stab. I had a sense of losing control of the car and slammed on the brakes in the middle of the road, then apologized and drove on. Here, within this quiet greenness, I possessed the only identity I had ever known, and I was losing it. In this brief moment of passage, I became aware of the connection between these lawns and buildings and my hopes and dreams. I wanted to stop the car and talk with Mr. Norton, to beg his pardon for what he had seen, to plead and show him tears, unashamed tears, like those of a child before his parent, to denounce all we'd seen and heard, to assure him that far from being like any of the people we had seen, I hated them, that I believed in the principles of the founder with all my heart and soul, and that I believed in his own goodness and kindness and extending the hand of his benevolence to helping us poor, ignorant people out of the mire and darkness. I would do his bidding and teach others to rise up as he wished them to, teach them to be thrifty, decent, upright citizens, contributing to the welfare of all, shunning all but the straight and narrow path that he and the founder had stretched before us. If only he were not angry with me, if only he would give me another chance. Tears filled my eyes, and the walks and buildings flowed and froze for a moment in the mist, glittering as in winter, when rain froze on the grass and foliage and turned the campus into a world of whiteness, waiting and bending both trees and bushes with fruit of crystal. Then in the twinkling of my eyes, it was gone, and the here and now of heat and greenness returned. If only I could make Mr. Norton understand what the school meant to me. Thank you.
As you may have read in your programs, Mary Poppins is not one of the books that has been banned for being salacious. what I believe some of the Southern ministers of the moral majority call flat-out schwitzig. Nobody has ever said that. It was banned, or it was removed from the shelves in San Francisco for having a stereotypical, or what was alleged to be a stereotypical presentation of African natives. When I read this, I realized that both of my own daughters had read the unexpurgated Mary Poppins. It's now been revised, is what I mean. They seem fine. I just wanted to put your mind at rest in case your kids have done the same thing. However, this passage seems to me somewhat suspicious on chapter 13. Now, she said, spit spot into bed. And she began to undress them. They noticed that whereas buttons and hooks had needed all sorts of coaxing from Katie Nana, for Mary Poppins they flew apart almost at a look. In less than a minute, they found themselves in bed and watching, by the dim light from the nightlight, the rest of Mary Poppins' unpacking being performed. From the carpet bag, she took out 7 flannel nightgowns, 4 cotton ones, a pair of boots, a set of dominoes, 2 bathing caps, and a postcard album. Last of all came a folding camp bedstead with blankets and eiderdown, complete, and this she set down between John's cot and Barbara's. Jane and Michael sat hugging themselves and watching. It was all so surprising that they could find nothing to say, but they knew, both of them, that something strange and wonderful had happened at number 17 Cherry Tree Lane. Mary Poppins, slipping one of the flannel nightgowns over her head, began to undress underneath it as though it were a tent. Michael, charmed by this strange new arrival, unable to keep silent any longer, called to her. "Mary Poppins," he cried, "you'll never leave us, will you?" There was no reply from under the nightgown. Michael could not bear it. "You won't leave us, will you?" he called anxiously. Mary Poppins' head came out of the top of the nightgown. She looked very fierce. "One word more from that direction," she said threateningly, "and I'll call the policeman." "I was only saying," began Michael meekly, "that we hoped you wouldn't be going away soon." He stopped, feeling very red and confused. Mary Poppins stared from him to Jane in silence. Then she sniffed. "I'll stay till the wind changes," she said shortly, and she blew out her candle and got into bed. "That's all right," said Michael, half to himself and half to Jane. But Jane wasn't listening. She was thinking about all that had happened and wondering.
Of course, the thing we shouldn't forget about banning books is the tremendous hostility in that toward children. We can take away their school lunches and then take away their books. This is from The Great Gatsby, which was removed from a library in Wisconsin and then returned some weeks later. "One October day in 1917, said Jordan Baker that afternoon, sitting up very straight on a straight chair in the tea garden at the Plaza Hotel. I was walking along from one place to another, half on the sidewalks and half on the lawns. I was happier on the lawns because I had on shoes from England with rubber knobs on the soles that bit into the soft ground. I had on a new plaid skirt also that blew a little in the wind, and whenever this happened, the red, white, and blue banners in front of all the houses stretched out stiff and said, tut, 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 in a disapproving way. The largest of the banners and the largest of the lawns belonged to Daisy Fay's house. She was just 18, 2 years older than me, and by far the most popular of all the young girls in Louisville. She dressed in white and had a little white roadster, and all day long the telephone rang in her house, and excited young officers from Camp Taylor demanded the privilege of monopolizing her that night, anyways, for an hour. When I came opposite her house that morning, her white roadster was beside the curb, and she was sitting in it with a lieutenant I hadn't seen before. They were so engrossed in each other that she didn't see me until I was 5 feet away. Hello, Jordan, she called unexpectedly. Please come here. I was flattered that she wanted to speak to me because of all the older girls I admired her most. She asked me if I was going to the Red Cross and make bandages. I was. Well then, would I tell him that she couldn't come that day? The officer looked at Daisy while she was speaking in a way that every young girl wants to be looked at sometime. And because it seemed romantic to me, I've remembered the incident ever since. His name was Jay Gatsby, and I didn't lay eyes on him again for over 4 years. Even after I'd met him on Long Island, I didn't realize he was the same man. That was 1917. By the next year, I had a few beaus myself, and I began to play in tournaments, so I didn't see Daisy very often. She went with a slightly older crowd when she went with anyone at all. Wild rumors were circulating about her, how her mother had found her packing her bag one winter night to go to New York and say goodbye to a soldier who was going overseas. She was effectually prevented, but she wasn't on speaking terms with her family for several weeks. Well, about 6 weeks ago, she heard the name Gatsby for the first time in years. It was when I asked you, do you remember if you knew Gatsby in West Egg? After you had gone home, she came into my room and woke me up and said, what Gatsby? And when I described him, I was half asleep. She said in the strangest voice that it must be the man she used to know. It wasn't until then that I connected this Gatsby with the officer in her white car.
From the end of The Bell Jar, because I think it's a book with a special meaning and appeal for younger readers, and the book censors are trying to separate it from its natural audience. And I'm reading these words tonight because Sylvia Plath isn't alive to defend herself against this miserable assault on her efforts. I hear you're leaving us. I fell into step beside Valerie in the little nurse-supervised group. Only if the doctors say yes. I have my interview tomorrow. The packed snow creaked underfoot, and everywhere I could hear a musical trickle and drip as the noon sun thawed icicles and snow crust that would glaze again before nightfall. The shadows of the massed black pines were lavender in that bright light, and I walked with Valerie a while down the familiar labyrinth of shoveled asylum paths. Doctors and nurses and patients passing on adjoining paths seemed to be moving on casters, cut off at the waist by the piled snow. Interviews, Valerie snorted. They're nothing. If they're going to let you out, they let you out. I hope so. In front of Kaplan, I said goodbye to Valerie's calm, snow-maned face behind which so little, bad or good, could happen, and walked on alone, my breath coming in white puffs, even in that sun-filled air. Valerie's last cheerful cry had been, so long, be seeing you. Not if I know it, I thought. But I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure at all. How did I know that someday, at college, in Europe, somewhere, anywhere, the bell jar with its stifling distortions wouldn't descend again? And hadn't Buddy said, as if to revenge himself for my digging out the car and having to stand by, I wonder who you'll marry now, Esther. What? I'd said, shoveling snow up onto a mound and blinking against the stinging back. Went unplugging and unplugging her little tubes without batting an eye. Yes, Irwin said. It's a bill for $20 for emergency attention on a certain date in December and a checkup a week thereafter. Yes, Irwin said. The hospital says they are sending me the bill because there was no answer to the bill they sent to you. All right, I'm writing a check now. I'm writing them a blank check. Irwin's voice altered subtly. When am I going to see you? Do you really want to know? Very much. Never, I said, and hung up with a resolute click. I wondered briefly if Irwin would send his check to the hospital after that, and then I thought, of course he will. He's a mathematics professor. He won't want to leave any loose ends. I felt unaccountably weak-kneed and relieved. Irwin's voice had meant nothing to me. This is the first time since our first and last meeting that I had spoken with him, and I was reasonably sure it would be the last. Irwin had absolutely no way of getting in touch with me except by going to Nurse Kennedy's flat. And after Joan's death, Nurse Kennedy had moved somewhere else and left no trace. I was perfectly free. Joan's parents invited me to the funeral. I had been, Mrs. Gilling said, one of Joan's best friends. You don't have to go, you know, Dr. Nolan told me. You can always write and say, I said it would be better not to. I'll go, I said. And I did go. And all during the simple funeral service, I wondered what I thought I was burying. At the altar, the coffin loomed in its snow pallor of flowers, the black shadow of something that wasn't there. The faces in the pews around me were waxen with candlelight and pine boughs left over from Christmas sent up incense in the cold air. Beside me, Jody's cheeks bloomed like good apples, and here and there in the little congregation, I recognized other faces of other girls from college and my hometown who had known Joan. Dee Dee and Nurse Kennedy bent their kerchiefed heads in the front pew. Then, beside the coffin and the flowers and the face of the minister and the faces of the mourners, I saw the rolling lawns of our town cemetery, knee-deep in snow now, with the tombstones rising out of it. Yes, Irwin said. The hospital says they are sending me the bill because there was no answer to the bill they sent to you. All right. I'm writing a check now. I'm writing them a blank check. Irwin's voice altered subtly. When am I going to see you? Do you really want to know? Very much. Never, I said, and hung up with a resolute click. I wondered briefly if Irwin would send his check to the hospital after that, and then I thought, of course he will. He's a mathematics professor. He won't want to leave any loose ends. I felt unaccountably weak-kneed and relieved. Irwin's voice had meant nothing to me. This is the first time since our first and last meeting that I had spoken with him, and I was reasonably sure it would be the last. Irwin had absolutely no way of getting in touch with me except by going to Nurse Kennedy's flat, and after Joan's death, Nurse Kennedy had moved somewhere else and left no trace. I was perfectly free. Joan's parents invited me to the funeral. I had been, Mrs. Gilling said, one of Joan's best friends. You don't have to go, you know, Dr. Nolan told me. You can always write and say, I said it would be better not to. I'll go, I said, and I did go. And all during the simple funeral service, I wondered what I thought I was burying. At the altar, the coffin loomed in its snow pallor of flowers, the black shadow of something that wasn't there. The faces in the pews around me were waxen with candlelight, and pine boughs left over from Christmas sent up incense in the cold air. Beside me, Jody's cheeks bloomed like good apples, and here and there in the little congregation, I recognized other faces of other girls from college and my hometown who had known Joan. Dee Dee and Nurse Kennedy bent their kerchiefed heads in the front pew. Then, beside the coffin and the flowers and the face of the minister and the faces of the mourners, I saw the rolling lawns of our town cemetery, knee-deep in snow now, with the tombstones rising out of it like smokeless chimneys. There would be a black 6-foot-deep gap hacked in the hard ground. That shadow would marry this shadow, and that peculiar yellowish soil of our locality seal the wound in the whiteness, and yet another snowfall erase the traces of newness in Joan's grave. I took a deep breath and listened to the old brag of my heart. I am, I am, I am.
I'm sorry to have to tell you that Studs Terkel was not able to make it tonight. He's been banned or censored by a snowstorm in Chicago. In Studs Terkel's place, it gives me pleasure to introduce to you now Thomas Patrick Gates, who was or is the fireman in Terkel's book, Working. Mr. Gates is now the Sergeant-at-Arms of the Uniformed Firefighters Association of New York. Mr. Gates.
I'd rather be in a fire now than be standing up here. When those bells went off before, I wanted to bail out of here. City cops, they got clubs. They think they are the elite. Housing is housing authority. They call us the ha-ha cops. Transit cops are called cave cops because they are in the subway. These are little ribs they give. Who's better? Who's New York's finest? I was in a park 3 years ago with a transit cop. We were with these two nice-looking girls. I was still single. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning. We had a couple of six-packs and a pizza pie. We're trying to make out, right? Cops pull up, city cops, and they shine a light on us. So my friend shows the cop his badge. The cop says, that's more of the reason you shouldn't be here. You were fucking on a job. Just get the fuck out of the park. Because he was a transit cop that gave him a hard time. My friend was going after this cop, and this cop was going after him. I grabbed him, and the driver in the police car grabbed his buddy, and they were yelling, keep out of the park. and the other guy yelling, "Don't come down in the subways." I could have turned around and said, "Don't ever come into housing projects." It was stupid shit. A guy pulled out a gun and get killed. I don't think it's funny because this kind of mentality is the leaders of this country, but they don't play with 38s. They play with atomic bombs and neutron bombs. What led me to be a cop? I'm not that smart to be a lawyer. A good day in school for me was when a teacher didn't call on me. I used to sit down in the back of the room and slide down into the seat so she didn't call on me. When I got pimples on my face, that made it worse. I was shy. You know, I got glasses here. I was shy. This book was written 10 years ago. I was shy with girls. One thing I told my father, "I'm gonna kill myself, I got pimples." He said, "I'll never forget it. The world's bigger than a pimple on your face." At that time, I didn't think it was. I used to pile Noxzema on my face, and I was with a girl making out, and she'd say, "I smell Noxzema." It used to be in my hair, up my nose. And when I smell Noxzema today, I could still see her face. I like mathematics. I could add like a bastard. I started getting into algebra, but then I got lost. I didn't want to raise my hand because I had the skin problem. It's crazy, right? I sunk down and the teacher never called on me for 2 years. And when she did call on me, it was just to leave the room. I didn't want to be a cop. Money comes into it. I was 26 and I worked in a post office and I wasn't making money, $2.18 an hour. I was young and I wanted to go out with the girls and I wanted to go down to the Jersey Shore. I wanted to buy a car. I just got out of the army. That's why I took it. When I became a cop, I thought I was going against my father. Cops are tools of the shit in Rockefeller. Cops can't understand when they build a new office building in Harlem. The people in our community want a hospital or a school. Rockefeller built that office building, right? Built by white construction workers, and these people demonstrate. Suppose they built in this neighborhood a state office building, and black people built it, and black people worked in it. The cops go in and break up the demonstrators. And who gets it? The cops. Rockefeller's a million miles away. Cops are working guys. They don't understand. Know why I switched to firemen? I like people. But sometimes I feel hate coming into me. I hated it to get me like that. I took the fire department test in 68 and got called in 70. I always wanted to be a fireman. My older brother was a fireman 11 years. He had a fire and the floor gave way. He was telling me the story. He thought it was just a one floor drop, but the guys grabbed him by the arms. They said, "If you go, Billy, we all go." He couldn't believe this kind of comradeship. They pulled him out. He went down to get his helmet. It was two floors down. He really would have got busted up. I like everybody working together. You chipping for a meal together. One guy goes to the store. One guy cooks. One guy washes the dishes. A common goal. We got a lieutenant there. He says the fire department is the closest thing to socialism there is. The officer is the first one into the fire. When you get to be a lieutenant or captain, you get more work, not less. That's why I took up to these. That's why I look up to these guys. We go to a fire. The lieutenant is the first one in. When I was in the Army, I didn't respect the officers because the men did all the work. That goes for the police department, too. Cops get killed. You never see a lieutenant get shot. The last three guys in the fire department were lieutenants that got killed because they are the first ones in there. I respect that. I want to respect an officer. I want to see somebody higher up that I can follow. I was in a fire one night. We had an all-hands fire, and all-hands is you got a working fire, and you're the first one in there, and the first guy in there is going to take the worst beating. You got the nozzle, the hose, you are taking a beating. If another company comes up behind you, you don't give up that nozzle. It's pride to put out a fire. We go over this with oxygen, tell the guy, "Get out, get oxygen." They won't leave. I think guys want to be heroes. You can't be a hero on Wall Street. These guys with black shit coming out of their ears, their noses, you got smoke in your hair. You could take a shower, you put your water on your hair and you can still smell the smoke. It never leaves you. You are coughing up this black shit, but you go back and you have coffee, maybe a couple of beers. You are psyched up. You get a fire, 2-3 in the morning. The lights go on. You get up, I yell, "Jesus, what's the matter? Dawn on me. Where else could we be going? All the lights going on, it's dark, it's fucking exciting." Guys are telling, "Come on, we go, we're first through." That means you gotta be the first engine company there. You really gotta move. It's pride, you gotta show you're the best. But what they are fighting over is good. What they are fighting over is saving lives. About 2 years ago, a young girl ran into the firehouse. She's yelling that her father had a heart attack. The guy was laying in the kitchen, right? He pissed in his pants, that's a sign of death. The fellow was lying there with his eyes open. Jimmy Finizzi pushes the guy 3 times in his chest because you got to shock his heart. The son was standing in the room just staring down. Go down on his mouth. You keep going and going. The guy threw up. You clean out his mouth. I was on a few minutes. Then Danny Gorman jumped on the guy's mouth. The captain bent down and said, "The guy's dead. Keep going for the family. Do it for the family." We took over 10 minutes, but it was a dead man. The son looked down at me and I looked up. He said, "Man, you tried everything. You tried." You know what I mean? I was proud of myself. I was gonna go down on a stranger, on his mouth. It's a great feeling. We had this fire. We had this fire down a block, a Puerto Rican social club. The captain and the other firemen took the ladder up and saved two people. But downstairs, there was a guy trying to get out the back door. They had bolts on the door. He was burnt dead. His fingernails had rotted down from trying to scrape his way out. Know what the lieutenant said? We lost a guy. We lost a guy. I said, you saved two people. How would you know at 6 in the morning a guy in a social club sleeping on a pool table? He said, yeah, but we lost a guy. You get guys that talk about niggas, spicks, and they're the first ones into the fire to save them. Of course we got guys with long hair and beards. One guy's an artist. His brother was killed in Vietnam, Jimmy Riley. That's why he's against the war. And these guys are all super firemen. It's you that takes the beating, and you won't give up. My wife sees television. Guys get killed. She tells me, be careful. Sometimes she calls up the firehouse. I tell her we had a bad job. Sometimes I don't. They got a saying in a firehouse, tonight could be the night. But nobody thinks of dying. You can't take it seriously because you get sick. We had some fires. I said, we're not going to get out of this. Like I say, everybody dies. A lot of guys want to be firemen. It's like kids. Guys 40 years old are kids. They try to be a hard guy. There's no big thing when you leave boyhood for manhood. It seems like I talk the same at 15 as I talk now. Everybody's still a kid. They just lose their hair or they don't fuck that much. I take that back. That was 10 years ago. When I was a kid, I was scared of heights. In a fire department, you got to go up a five-story building with a rope around you. You got to jump off a building. You know the rope can hold 1,600 pounds as long as you got confidence in your body and you know the guy's holding you. You got nothing to be scared of. I think you perform with people looking at you. You're in the limelight. You're out there with the people and kids. Kids wave at you. When I was a kid, we waved at firemen. It's like a place in the sun. Last month, there was a second alarm. I was off duty. I ran over there. I'm a bystander. I see these firemen on the roof with the smoke pouring out around them and the flames, and they go in. It fascinated me. Jesus Christ, that's what I do. I was fascinated by the people's faces. You could see the pride that they were seeing. The fucking world's fucked up. The country's fucked up. But the firemen, you actually see them produce. You see them put out a fire. You see them come out with the babies in their hands. You see them give mouth to mouth when a guy's dying. You can't get around that shit. That's real. To me, that's what I want to be. I worked in a bank, you know? It's just paper. It's not real. 9 to 5 and it's shit. You're looking at numbers, but I can look back and say, I helped put out a fire. I helped save somebody. It shows something I did on this earth. I want to say something about four-letter words. I have been a New York City firefighter for 12 years. It was a great honor to see my name printed in Studs Terkel's book. In 1979, I was elected by the firefighters of this city as Sergeant-at-Arms of the Uniformed Firefighters Association, the largest local union of firefighters in the United States, Canada, and the state of Georgia. To see my name printed in a book made this nobody feel like somebody. And now this somebody represents the working-class heroes of this city, the New York City firefighters. On August 2nd, 1978, I was on vacation. I was walking along a country road with my kids. My father came running out of the house screaming that six firemen were killed in a fire in Brooklyn. The roof collapsed, sending them into the flames. What was left was buckles and badges and 16 kids without a daddy. I turned around, went into the house, took off my clothes, and turned on a shower. I did not shout, damn it, damn it, damn it. I said, fuck, 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 and it made me feel better.
Company of so many illustrious writers whom I read and dearly love. In 1975, in this infamous Island Trees district in New York, a book called Reader for Writers was banned because of two essays contained therein, one by Robert Penn Warren, which made reference to Malcolm X, the other by Jonathan Swift, the author of Gulliver's Travels, which you obviously know, was born in Dublin of Irish parents,
and published this essay in October of 1729, 253 years ago, before he wrote Gulliver's Travels. And it's from that essay that I'd like to read now. A modest proposal for preventing the children of poor people from being a burden to their parents or the country, and for making them beneficial to the public. It is a melancholy object to those who walk through this great town of Dublin when they see the streets crowded with beggars of the female sex, followed by 3, 4, or 6 children, all in rags and importuning every passenger for an alms. I think it is agreed by all parties that this prodigious number of children in the arms or on the backs or at the heels of their mothers and frequently of their fathers is, in the present deplorable state of the kingdom, a very great additional grievance, and therefore, whoever could find out a fair, cheap, and easy method of making these children sound and useful members of the Commonwealth would deserve so well of the public as to have his statue set up for a preserver of the nation. Now, I have been assured by a very knowing American of my acquaintance in London that a young, healthy child, well nursed, is at a year old a most delicious, nourishing, and wholesome food. Whether stewed, roasted, baked, or boiled, and I make no doubt that it will equally serve in a fricassee or ragout. I do therefore humbly offer it to public consideration that 100,000 at a year old be offered in sale to the persons of quality and fortune through the kingdom, always advising the mother to let them suck plentifully in the last month so as to render them plump and fat for a good table. A child will make 2 dishes at an entertainment for friends, and when the family dines alone, the fore or hind quarter will make a reasonable dish, and seasoned with a little salt or pepper, will be very good boiled on the 4th day, especially in winter. I have reckoned upon a medium that a child just born will weigh 12 pounds, and in a solar year, if tolerably nursed, increaseth to 28 pounds. I believe no gentleman would repine to give 10 shillings for the carcass of a good, fat child. Those who are more thrifty may flay the carcass, the skin of which, artificially dressed, will make admirable gloves for ladies and summer boots for fine gentlemen. As to our city of Dublin, meat markets may be appointed for this purpose in the most convenient parts of it, and butchers, we may be assured, will not be wanting, although I rather recommend buying the children alive and dressing them hot from the knife, as we do roasting pigs. I think the advantages by the proposal which I have made are obvious, and many as well as of the highest importance. It would greatly lessen the number of papists with whom we are yearly overrun. The poorer tenants will have something valuable of their own. The constant breeders, besides the gain of 8 shillings sterling per annum by the sale of their children, will be rid of the charge of maintaining them after the first year. We shall soon see an honest emulation among the married women, which of them could bring the fattest child to market. Men would become as fond of their wives during their time of pregnancy as they are now of their mares in foal or their cows in calf, nor offer to beat or kick them, as it is too frequent a practice, for fear of miscarriage. Pigs, too frequent at our tables, are no way comparable in taste to magnificence to a well-grown, fat, yearling child, which roasted whole will make a considerable figure at a Lord Mayor's feast or any other public entertainment, particularly weddings and christenings. I compute that Dublin would take off annually about 20,000 carcasses, and the rest of the kingdom, where probably they'd be sold somewhat cheaper, the remaining 80,000. I can think of no one objection that will possibly be raised against this proposal, unless it should be urged that the number of people will be thereby much lessened in the kingdom. This I freely own, and it was indeed one principal design in offering it to the world. I desire the
I'm reading to you from the 30th anniversary edition of Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison. No mean feat, staying in print and actively read for 30 years. A book banned in 1975, apparently upon the occasion of a reference to breasts, one in connection with bitch, and another the word nigger, for which the students and the readers of that community were prevented, or someone hoped they would be prevented, from reading this extraordinary classic in American literature, one of whose passages for poignancy and tenderness and humor and lyricism I read now. The wheel felt like an alien thing in my hands as I followed the white line of the highway. Heat rays from the late afternoon sun rose from the gray concourse, shimmering like the weary tones of a distant bugle blown upon still midnight air. In the mirror, I could see Mr. Norton staring out vacantly upon the empty fields, his mouth stern, his white forehead livid where it had scraped the screen. And seeing him, I felt the fear balled coldly within me unfold. What would happen now? What would the school officials say? In my mind, I visualized Dr. Bledsoe's face when he saw Mr. Norton. I thought of the glee certain folks at home would feel if I were expelled. Tatlock's grinning face danced through my mind. What would the white folks think who'd sent me to college? Was Mr. Norton angry at me? In the golden day, he had seemed more curious than anything else, until the vet had started talking wild. Damn True Blood. It was his fault. If we hadn't sat in the sun so long, Mr. Norton would not have needed whiskey, and I wouldn't have gone to the golden day. And why would the vets act that way with a white man in the house? I headed the car through the red brick camp skate posts with a sense of cold apprehension. Now even the rows of neat dormitories seemed to threaten me. The rolling lawns appeared as hostile as the gray highway with its white dividing line. As of its own compulsion, the car slowed as we passed the chapel with its low, sweeping eaves. The sun shone coolly through the avenue of trees, dappling the curving drive. Students strolled through the shade, down a hill of tender grass toward the brick-red stretch of tennis courts. Far beyond, players in whites showed sharp against the red of the court surrounded by grass, a gay vista washed by the sun. In the brief interval, I heard a cheer arise. My predicament struck me like a stab. I had a sense of losing control of the car and slammed on the brakes in the middle of the road, then apologized and drove on. Here, within this quiet greenness, I possessed the only identity I had ever known, and I was losing it. In this brief moment of passage, I became aware of the connection between these lawns and buildings and my hopes and dreams. I wanted to stop the car and talk with Mr. Norton, to beg his pardon for what he had seen, to plead and show him tears, unashamed tears, like those of a child before his parent, to denounce all we'd seen and heard, to assure him that far from being like any of the people we had seen, I hated them, that I believed in the principles of the founder with all my heart and soul, and that I believed in his own goodness and kindness and extending the hand of his benevolence to helping us poor, ignorant people out of the mire and darkness. I would do his bidding and teach others to rise up as he wished them to, teach them to be thrifty, decent, upright citizens, contributing to the welfare of all, shunning all but the straight and narrow path that he and the founder had stretched before us. If only he were not angry with me, if only he would give me another chance. Tears filled my eyes, and the walks and buildings flowed and froze for a moment in the mist, glittering as in winter when rain froze on the grass and foliage and turned the campus into a world of whiteness, waiting and bending both trees and bushes with fruit of crystal. Then in the twinkling of my eyes, it was gone, and the here and now of heat and greenness returned. If only I could make Mr. Norton understand what the school meant to me. Thank you.
As you may have read in your programs, Mary Poppins is not one of the books that has been banned for being salacious. What I believe some of the Southern ministers of the moral majority call flat-out schwitzig. Nobody has ever said that. It was banned, or it was removed from the shelves in San Francisco for having a stereotypical, or what was alleged to be a stereotypical presentation of African natives. When I read this, I realized that both of my own daughters had read the unexpurgated Mary Poppins. It's now been revised, is what I mean. They seem fine. I just wanted to put your mind at rest in case your kids have done the same thing. However, this passage seems to me somewhat suspicious on chapter 13. Now, she said, spit spot into bed. And she began to undress them. They noticed that whereas buttons and hooks had needed all sorts of coaxing from Katie Nana, for Mary Poppins they flew apart almost at a look. In less than a minute, they found themselves in bed and watching, by the dim light from the nightlight, the rest of Mary Poppins' unpacking being performed. From the carpet bag, she took out 7 flannel nightgowns, 4 cotton ones, a pair of boots, a set of dominoes, 2 bathing caps, and a postcard album. Last of all came a folding camp bedstead with blankets and eiderdown complete, and this she set down between John's cot and Barbara's. Jane and Michael sat hugging themselves and watching. It was all so surprising that they could find nothing to say, but they knew, both of them, that something strange and wonderful had happened at number 17 Cherry Tree Lane. Mary Poppins, slipping one of the flannel nightgowns over her head, began to undress underneath it as though it were a tent. Michael, charmed by this strange new arrival, unable to keep silent any longer, called to her. Mary Poppins, he cried, you'll never leave us, will you? There was no reply from under the nightgown. Michael could not bear it. You won't leave us, will you? He called anxiously. Mary Poppins' head came out of the top of the nightgown. She looked very fierce. One word more from that direction, she said threateningly, and I'll call the policeman. I was only saying, began Michael meekly, that we hoped you wouldn't be going away soon. He stopped, feeling very red and confused. Mary Poppins stared from him to Jane in silence. Then she sniffed. I'll stay till the wind changes, she said shortly, and she blew out her candle and got into bed. That's all right, said Michael, half to himself and half to Jane. But Jane wasn't listening. She was thinking about all that had happened and wondering.
course, the thing we shouldn't forget about banning books is the tremendous hostility in that toward children. We can take away their school lunches and then take away their books. This is from The Great Gatsby, which was removed from a library in Wisconsin and then returned some weeks later. One October day in 1917, said Jordan Baker that afternoon, sitting up very straight on a straight chair in the tea garden at the Plaza Hotel. I was walking along from one place to another, half on the sidewalks and half on the lawns. I was happier on the lawns because I had on shoes from England with rubber knobs on the soles that bit into the soft ground. I had on a new plaid skirt also that blew a little in the wind, and whenever this happened, the red, white, and blue banners in front of all the houses stretched out stiff and said, tut, 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 in a disapproving way. The largest of the banners and the largest of the lawns belonged to Daisy Fay's house. She was just 18, 2 years older than me, and by far the most popular of all the young girls in Louisville. She dressed in white and had a little white roadster, and all day long the telephone rang in her house, and excited young officers from Camp Taylor demanded the privilege of monopolizing her that night, anyways, for an hour. When I came opposite her house that morning, her white roadster was beside the curb, and she was sitting in it with a lieutenant I hadn't seen before. They were so engrossed in each other that she didn't see me until I was 5 feet away. "Hello, Jordan," she called unexpectedly. "Please come here." I was flattered that she wanted to speak to me because of all the older girls I admired her most. She asked me if I was going to the Red Cross and make bandages. I was. Well then, would I tell them that she couldn't come that day? The officer looked at Daisy while she was speaking in a way that every young girl wants to be looked at sometime. And because it seemed romantic to me, I've remembered the incident ever since. His name was Jay Gatsby, and I didn't lay eyes on him again for over 4 years. Even after I'd met him on Long Island, I didn't realize he was the same man. That was 1917. By the next year, I had a few beaus myself, and I began to play in tournaments, so I didn't see Daisy very often. She went with a slightly older crowd when she went with anyone at all. Wild rumors were circulating about her, how her mother had found her packing her bag one winter night to go to New York and say goodbye to a soldier who was going overseas. She was effectually prevented, but she wasn't on speaking terms with her family for several weeks. After that, she didn't play around with the soldiers anymore, but only with a few flat-footed, short-sighted among hard-drinking people. Well, about 6 weeks ago, she heard the name Gatsby for the first time in years. It was when I asked you, do you remember if you knew Gatsby in West Egg? After you had gone home, she came into my room and woke me up and said, "What Gatsby?" And when I described him, I was half asleep. She said in the strangest voice that it must be the man she used to know. It wasn't until then that I connected this Gatsby with the officer in her white car.
I'm going to read from the end of The Bell Jar, because I think it's a book with a special meaning and appeal for younger readers, and the book censors are trying to separate it from its natural audience. And I'm reading these words tonight because Sylvia Plath isn't alive to defend herself against this miserable assault on her efforts. I hear you're leaving us. I fell on the step beside Valerie in the little nurse-supervised group. Only if the doctors say yes. I have my interview tomorrow. The packed snow creaked underfoot, and everywhere I could hear a musical trickle and drip as the noon sun thawed icicles and snow crust that would glaze again before nightfall. The shadows of the massed black pines were lavender in that bright light, and I walked with Valerie a while down the familiar labyrinth of shoveled asylum paths. Doctors and nurses and patients passing on adjoining paths seemed to be moving on casters, cut off at the waist by the piled snow. "Interviews," Valerie snorted. "They're nothing. If they're going to let you out, they let you out." I hope so. In front of Kaplan, I said goodbye to Valerie's calm, snow-maned face behind which so little, bad or good, could happen, and walked on alone, my breath coming in white puffs, even in that sun-filled air. Valerie's last cheerful cry had been, "So long, be seeing you." "Not if I know it," I thought. But I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure at all. How did I know that someday, at college, in Europe, somewhere, anywhere, the bell jar with its stifling distortions wouldn't descend again? And hadn't Buddy said, as if to revenge himself for my digging out the car and having to stand by, "I wonder who you'll marry now, Esther." "What?" I'd said, shoveling snow up onto a mound and blinking against the stinging back.